Hi. Hi. Welcome to the Journeys webcast. It's not what I thought I would be doing this week for the webcast, but it's with heavy heart and tear-stained eyes that I'm here. And I see so many of you. I look at this people. This is the largest in the first couple minutes of chat of comments I've had in 37 episodes of this. So thank you. Before I start, I just gonna a couple technical things. Some of you are coming onto the room and chat with us. The way that that works is I'm gonna invite you into the room. You can raise your hand too at some point. I've got some definite scheduled guests, and then anybody else, we've got about 48, 50 minutes. And afterwards, I'm gonna play the webcast from, it actually was on April 27th, 2020, but it was posted live on the replay on a year ago to the date that Jeff left us. I should put my glasses on here because I can't see that. But I wanted to kind of say something here. Jeff is with us right now. And in fact, in many ways, Jeff hasn't left us, right? I mean, he had a spark, a kindness. I call him actually, this is what I call Jeff, a prince of kindness, compassion, and humility. You know, one of the things he would always do is check in with all of us. I know you get the emails. I got them. For a guy that is busy, was writing, doing workshops, had so many projects going, he never lacked the time to reach out and just ask a simple question like, hey, Alan, how are you doing? And his emails were always whimsical and funny. And that was just him. He shared and he shed light and joy on anyone he came in contact with. So with that in mind, and if you guys have a candle, join me because I'm going to shine a little light on Jeff. Because he also had a lot of fire. So with light and fire, Jeff's going to be with me right here. The other thing Jeff, of course, would be doing if we were doing this right now is probably having a scotch. So since I don't have any scotch, I'm going to have a little bit of wine because he would have a glass of wine with me too, often on his deck at his beautiful place in Encinitas that we just saw some pictures with. So if you guys out there want to join in a toast to Jeff's life, we can do that too, virtually or like that. So I'm going to pour a glass of wine and cheers, Jeff. This is for you. And thank you all for coming in. You know, I did have a great conversation interview, and I will play that at the 4 o'clock hour. If you want to stick around and watch it, if you missed it, it's fantastic. It is truly Jeff Sauls. The other thing that, as I was kind of going through my Jeff memories, I realized that he and I did. I do a podcast too. It's not as consistent as this webcast because I've been in lockdown, so I couldn't go anywhere. The podcast happens when I can get around to it. And in May of 2016, Jeff and I sat on my patio right out here at dusk while a mockingbird kept mocking us, I guess. He told stories from China, South America, and I'm going to put a link up to that. You know, if you need a little bit of more dose of Jeff, it's a great conversation. I talked about him running the cops when he was out in Western China. So there's some really cool stories in there. So I'm going to put that up for a minute. You can bookmark that link. Before I bring in my first guest here, or Jeff's first guest, I put together a little video, a little tribute video that I'd like to play while we toast, shed the light and fire on us from Jeff. So please enjoy a little bit more of the guy we miss so much. Thank you.
Hi, this is Dr. Jeff Saltz. I want to talk to you for a few minutes about nothing.
My name is Jeff Saltz, and I am a Cuencaholic, although I prefer to refer to myself as a Gringano.
So I decided I would write the ultimate adventure book, an upbeat book about dying, death, decay, disintegration. We need one of those. And I called it Into Thin Hair.
Opening your heart, connecting to the people in that room. Jaffe says I shouldn't say connecting, but radiating. And I think it's true. I think for me, what I really try and do, and I believe this to be absolutely at some physical level a fact, that we do step in front of an audience and we have the capacity to radiate golden light and caring, genuine caring, that will at some level seep into osmotically every single person in that room. It's the kind of wisdom that our bodies have to discern what's true and what's not true, that we've evolved over millennia.
I'm headed this afternoon to see my dad in Florida. He's 94. He has his picture on his wall. No one's ever guessed which is his son. How bad do you have to look? How much do you have to suffer before you get the message, which to me is this, the meaning of life? It's simple. There's nowhere to go and nothing to do except for the chance that we have to be of service, which is the job that we get to do every single day. I've always wanted to destroy my ego, but I never could because I'm attached to my seething intellect and my powerful good looks until this part of life. Those things are being stripped from me one by one by one. There's no place to feel really egotistic. It's like, there's no place for ego to hang its hat. And so it wanders out the door, but it leaves that door open and the deep sense and profound feeling of joy enters in its place. That is the gift of life.
I think in times of change, the adventure at hand is to go beyond that which has worked so far because we must and begin to imagine what might be possible. And despite the fingers of the naysayers, the nabobs of nattering naysaying pointing at us, insist on living that dream.
So I was really inspired by these three individuals and I ran away, bought a gym membership and I worked out. I burned 2,000 calories in the morning. I drank paleo shakes. I could just feel myself losing weight and getting better looking, and then came day two.
Although our lives are very different, and my mountaineering exploring was my own idea, and his was non-intentional, compulsory adventuring, as a lost boy and all the things he went through, the inner journey was very much the same, and the place to which we arrived was very similar.
Because Jaffe and I moved here about 4 years ago, and increasingly this is our home. We are gringos in Cuenca, and we are the gringos of Cuenca. We are individuals who feel our roots deepening and our home becoming more and more here in Cuenca.
Wow, doesn't that bring back some memories? Awesome. I see a lot of you want to say a few words. We're going to get to as many as I help everybody who wants to say something for sure. I can see people have put their hands up to speak. So that's good. So if you want to speak, do that. I want to say one thing more about those emails and messages I would get from Jeff. He would always have so much encouragement and so much support. Again, talk about time. I wrote an article years ago called Time. It's the most precious gift anyone can give you. And Jeff was so generous with his time. And he would read every one of my blog posts. And he would a lot of times send me a personal email commenting on something he liked or even if there was something he felt maybe he didn't like. And that was the other thing, is he was always so honest. And let's face it, those are just such great great memories, how his generosity there. Wow, this is, look how many people are here. You know what? There's almost 100 people here. I really am humbled that you'll spend the time with me, but I know it's not about me, because this is for Jeff, and I couldn't think of anything else to do. When Christian called me on Wednesday, for a guy who talks a lot, who's also a speaker, and I never am lacking words, I think Christian will go, Alan, are you there? And I lost my voice. I really did. So, Vince. So we'll wait. I'm not hearing from George. So I'll tell you what, I'm going to bring Vince on right now. Vince, I just invited you as a presenter, so you can kind of come on and share your adventure stories. So many of you I know have known Jeff so much longer than I have. I am blessed to have known him for about a decade. And it was George Walter who introduced us at the first time. And that's why I wanted to bring him up here first, because if it wasn't for George, I might not know Jeff. I may know of Jeff, who didn't know of Jeff, but he lived literally about 2 miles from my house here when they were living in Jaffe and he were living in Encinitas. And okay, Vince is entering the room. How are you?
Holding it together, man. I don't know how you're doing this.
It's so good to see you, and I love the old ski poles in the background. That's so cool. Of course, would Vince have there? You know,
well,
legendary skier.
More of an architectural accent than an actual skis that I used in the 1918 Olympics.
So, Jeff, why? Right? Don't we always ask that question in these parts?
Yeah. He. It's when you asked about the kinds of memories of Jeff Sauls, everything pointed to playfulness. Like every memory that I have was about us just playing around. Although at times he would say things, you know, you would go, wow, that guy really knows his shit. Or he's always so learned and well-read and, you know, learning that he was a professor and all that. But it was the playfulness that... I keep scanning. When we first met, actually, it was at an NSA convention, and there was a hallway, and the parents, for some reason, had brought their little kids, and these kids were just bored out of their skulls, and I don't know what came over me, but I didn't know who the kids were, but I was playing with these kids, and I was rolling around on the carpet with these kids, right? They were maybe 4 or 5 years old, and Sauls, as I understand, looked over and said, now that's a guy I want to know.
And for those of you who are in this community, I know a lot of you are speakers and, you know that the NSA, we're not talking about the security agency. we're talking about the, as I think the NSA is National Speaker Association. We're the ones who like to speak, not listen.
Right. Not the National Listeners Association.
Hey, real quick, George.
Yeah, I'm here.
I see that you are here. So hang loose, make sure you're using your headphones, because we were getting a little echo for a minute there.
You got me now?
Yeah. Okay. So we're going to let Vince go. You hang out there. We're going to bring you on in just a second. And you should turn your camera on too as well, George, so you can actually join there. Anyway, so yeah, NSA, National Speakers Association. How long have you known him?
Jeff, gosh, we ended up having the same agent, Karen Harris. God, that must have been 15 years ago, 2005, maybe? 2005?
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then he did classic Jeff, maybe 2004. He gave one of those classic calls. Jeff goes, hey, you want to climb a mountain? And I said, well, I've never climbed a mountain. He says, nobody else has either. So we all got to go on this trek in the Himalayas in 2006 and summited a mountain on September 11th, 2006, an auspicious day, and very moving experience. I mean, Jeff would say nature is the lazy teacher's classroom, and And he never saw himself as a lazy teacher, but he saw himself as a teacher. I know that. So, yeah.
Yeah. So what your memories are always about fun and joy, and that's what Jeff brought all of us. Is there anything that you reach back in your memories that, like that story of running into him for the first time at the NSA convention that really, illustrates that passion he had, that spark, a guy could pull a pun out of his pocket at a moment's notice.
That's a superpower. It always caught me off guard. I don't know about you, but he would get these puns and I would go, oh, how do you think of that stuff consistently? And I'm always taken aback. Like, he has another one. I mean, I think that's how his brain worked. He just kept thinking, is there a pun there? Is there a pun there? Is there a pun there? So that was something he always did. We had one time, one lesson I learned from Jeff was how to climb. And he had a special way of climbing. Like, he would rest his leg and lift it and step. And so he would rest between steps, basically. It's hard to describe, but I'll be darned if it didn't work really well. Cause some of these treks were exhausting, and he would just be sure to take care of the people that he was with. And then being able to climb with Yeshi and Jack separately, and just being able to be introduced to his circle of friends and new friends as well, who remain friends to this day, you included. So it's very cherished, and it's just so hard to believe he's gone. But there's one other memory. He kept bringing it up to me. We were so frustrated in India. We were at this little mini airport, and it was just one of these things. Things just weren't going well, and he's the leader. And so I got on the luggage rack and went in one of these carousels, and I was just sitting with all the luggage going by, just looking straight ahead as it went by. And he again, playfulness, he really responded to that. Maybe that's why we got along so well. And I miss him already.
I can't believe I think the last email I had was the end of March. We were going back, and then Jaffe, we would have, also email. I heard from Jaffe on, I go through all of this stuff, just kind of trying to process it. And it was on, April 12th. And I had no idea. I had no idea.
Yeah.
None of us did. I mean,
yeah. Hard to know detail.
Strange world. You put together a bit of a little tribute too. Do you want me to run that, or do you want to say something else?
Well, let me just say that I threw it together today, this morning, actually. So you're not going to get broadcast quality, but I was able to pull a couple of videos that of him speaking, but also a voice. I was clearing. This was last night. I was clearing my voicemails, just going through voicemails because it said almost full.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, there was one from Jeff, and to hear his voice, and it epitomizes, in this video, you'll hear it, but it epitomizes Jeff Sahls. So go ahead.
Okay, thank you.
So all of that, and to bring friends together in a very meaningful way. I know the kind of friendships that form, and the kind of friendships that deepen when you're on a trip like this. I really was looking forward to having a time in the wilderness, in high mountains, in an area that's infused not just the beauty, but the spirit of the Lepcha people and of Buddhism, to put some space between my ears so that I can again return to the joyful, nature-connected self that I know that I am, and return more spirited, more vital, more relaxed.
Dr. Pazinti, I presume. This is Jeffrey Brian Sahls calling you from Cuenca, Ecuador. And we're concerned, and we're sure you're fine, but just want you to know that Jeff and I are thinking about you, thinking warm thoughts, And of course, I've been thinking about you for a few days, but finally found the time in my busy schedule to pick up the phone and I just called to say I love you. Thank you, Stevie Wonder. I'll let him sing the song, but I will express the sentiment. And just let you know, we're thinking about you and Michelle and the family. And hope that you're okay. When you get a moment, call us and let us know you're fine and tell us a story or two. I'm sure this is going to make for some great material. Love you, brother. Bye-bye. Yeah.
Adventure's always more fun in retrospect.
Here's to retrospect.
Dude, broadcast quality. That was cinematic. You outdid yourself on that. Oh my.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That voicemail just popped out. Just.
I had no idea you had the COVID. And that was Jeff, you know, he would. Yeah, you know, I got strict with in lockdown with vertigo, and I'm still actually dealing with it. And he would check in with me like at least once a month. Yeah, there's still an echo in here. I don't know if you. Anyway, maybe it's just me. I'm hearing it. I don't. Maybe no one else is hearing it. Oh, but. He had that compassion, that empathy. He would take time out of the day just because he had a concern and wanted to know how you're doing. God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that he led by example, right? So
yeah,
for sure. Something I'll keep.
Yeah. You can't
follow that example. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I just on a side note, you know, my dad passed away a few years ago and I found a couple voicemails. And it's interesting, cause at his memorial, which was, we were able to do in person. Imagine that.
Back in the day.
And I played the voicemail. So I love that you did that because it's so timely and the way you overplayed the, anyway, just thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for being part of this. I know others want to speak too. And
yeah,
I know George Walther has been uncharacteristically silent so far. So,
well, I'm going to bring George into the room and I want to thank you for coming. Hopefully you'll stick around and listen to everybody else. There's so many people on the chat. So, Vince, thank you. And here's to Adventure and Jeff.
Thank you.
Okay, let's see if we can do this. George!
Hey, I've been here. It's not technology that's failed us.
George, look, wait a minute. What's up with all this color? I mean, I you outdid me. I was trying to do my best Sauls with my outfit, but you're, you know.
Hey, here we are to celebrate the life of the most colorful person any of us are ever going to know. And there was absolutely nothing drab about Jeff Saltz.
Well, you know, that is for sure. You know, you famously introduced us and perhaps you could try. You had contacted, I'll set it up. I'll frame it a bit, but you had contacted Jeff and say, hey, I met this guy, Alan, at the NSA. He's a, you know, up and coming speaker adventurer. Would you mind meeting with him? And he was open, but you know, he's still a busy guy and he was a little reluctant. He's like, all right, it's George. So I'll let Alan stop by for a little bit. And he timed it so it would happen before dinner so he could get me out of there quickly. Now you can finish the story because he told it every time I met somebody new.
Well, it's because I knew. I got your vibe and I got his vibe. And it's my vibe, too. We're adventurers. We don't care about Marriotts. We want to be in the thick of it. And I just knew as soon as I talked with you that he and you and I were all in the same tribe. And the reason I'm wearing colors is because I mean, I've been crying all week. Many of us on this call have been so sad about losing Jeff. And you're so right. He's here with us. And I hope that Jack and Yeshi, his two great kids, are on the call too, because his light, his color, is carrying through to the next generation. And there is nothing about this guy who is black and white. And in fact, I looked through my old emails after the last 25 years from Jeff. There's nothing in black. Everything is colorful. He always used a crazy colorful font. There was always a picture of a jester. And Jeff was such a jester and at the same time, such a safe, reliable person. There were times, and Vince will recall this, we went to Sikkim, which is between Bhutan and Tibet and Nepal, and we're high in the Himalayas. And I remember thinking at the time, if I were 25, this would be the toughest thing I've ever done. But I was 65, and it was really tough. But I always knew if Jeff is there, he's going to make sure things turn out all right. And I remember being at one point where there was a huge landslide and the whole village had been washed away and the trail was blocked. And normal people would say, oh, geez, we can't go forward. The trail's gone. Not Jeff. He's going like, hey, we get to see a different side of this landslide. And that was just his spirit, always to find the good. And I never remember Jeff ever saying something negative. Always a positive, laughing guy. And those of us on the call who've been in his presence, it's the laugh we miss, and it's the spirit behind that laugh. And it's up to us to carry it forward. And I know as I make wardrobe decisions, I'm going to think, wait, would Jeff approve of this? No, you and I have conspired, Alan, to say, well, this colorful guy, I mean, this hat is from that track in Sikkim. And that's the guy who brought such life and color into our lives. We're not going to let that stop.
No. And I love that you've got the world map behind you, the globe and the Tibetan flags. Now, you have trekked with him, obviously, all over Asia and spent weeks with him and Lisa in Ecuador. Yeah. Trekking you so not only do you share the in like Vince, you know, you know as a speaker, professional speaker, it goes a lot deeper in that, but those experiences on the treks, what memories come to you, or what thoughts about how Jeff was as a leader?
First of all, you knew he was strong. I'm not a mountaineer. He's a mountaineer. I knew that he'd carried people off the mountain who had trekked with him, climbed with him, who didn't make it. And he didn't abandon them. He brought them down. And I knew that if anything went wrong with me, in fact, I remember on one of the Himalaya treks that he was not able to participate on. He had a medical condition at the last minute. He had to pull out. And we were hiking along, and I said to the Ankit Sood, I hope he's with us. I said to Ankit, well, what happens if something goes wrong? And Ankit says, oh, don't worry, we'll get a helicopter. And then, I have never seen a helicopter anywhere around here. We'll call it. But there's no cell service. I thought, oh, if only Jeff were here. I know Jeff would carry me out of there if necessary. So it was a sense of security and certainty that Jeff was in control and would laugh at whatever circumstance came along. What a colorful, bright light he shined for all of us.
Yeah, amen on that. Wow.
And Lisa Jaffe, who I hope is with us, or we'll see it later, you know, as an example, I don't have possessions. Jeff didn't have possessions. We lived in the moment. And I remember that Lisa and my last visit with them in Ecuador made this painted stone for me. It's one of the very few things I carry with me. I'm never going to lose it, because for me, it symbolizes that whole idea of, what do you need, something fancy, a status? No, a rock with some color on it.
is all you need to be reminded of what these people brought into our lives. By the way, Yeshi, his daughter, was with us on that the last trek I participated in. And I know that she is carrying his spirit and always will. Lisa, by the way, one of Jeff's joys was to bring people to areas that he that you wouldn't otherwise be. And I would not have found myself in the Himalayas without Jeff. And I remember when we landed, headed for Sikkim, and we were at an airport, Gangtok. And Lisa, remember, as we left the airport, we were riding in this very wildly painted truck. And Lisa looked over and said, "Oh, look, they're having a family barbecue by the river." Okay. Yeah, it was a barbecue, all right. It was Grandpa that was being barbecued. We all had this big laugh. Yeah, it's a family barbecue, all right. What a joy. What a love she is. And those of us who were there at the wedding will always remember that those two were meant to be together. And Lisa is going to carry forward his spirit.
Hey, I'm going to, that just brings me a reminder, and I forgot to do this earlier. I put up the link for the podcast, but there is a GoFundMe page that was started by Lisa's brother, and I'm going to, okay, here it goes. I'm going to put it up. You'll see it there. If you haven't heard about it, that you might want to go there. It's so many generous people. I mean, I don't recognize any of the names, but I mean, there was even one gentleman who contributed $5,000. So she's got a lot of challenges ahead, you know, with Jeff gone. So for those of you on, there's a link. Go to that link if you feel up to it. Please share that link with your friends or anyone who knew Jeff or Jaffe. That's a good place to show a little more love too, because I think she's probably going to have to come back here, and you know, there's a lot of logistics, you know.
And it's only Jeff's body that is gone. I love that production that Vince made with the guys with the big horns, that it's a disembodied soul. The body's gone. The soul of Jeff is with us, and I hope we all live with more color in our lives. He was not a gray guy. There was no black, white.
There was no.
He'd never send a text typewritten in, you know, Garamond or Helvetia font. No, it was always some wild, colorful font in bright colors. Let's live that way.
Yeah, let's live that way. Cheers to that, George. I want to thank you so much for, number one, introducing me to Jeff, to allowing me to have the joy, the inspiration, the encouragement and support from a fellow speaker. It kills me.
Well, you brought it to him as well, and you bring it to me. Everybody who knows you has that same spirit as Jeff Saltz.
I love you, George. Thank you for coming on. I want to bring in one of Jeff's oldest friends, Bobo, who a lot of you may know, and I get him in there. Bobo, I sent you a invite to come on. I'm going to get to Eileen, Christian, and certainly Ken, Jamie, Eric. We're going to get you in the room real soon. So thank you, George. Come on in, Bobo. I want to talk to you because you knew Jeff decades before I knew him. And I know that you also share a second generation a family that you're with Yeshi and Jacinto, AKA Jack. Yeah. So, oh, George, it's crazy.
Yeah. And let's all remember to love each other.
Yeah. And as somebody, it's been really amazing how many people who I've never met, but shared Jeff as a friend, who through my emails and forwarding around this wacky world that we are, have sent me notes about stories about Jeff or just thanking me for doing this. And I am overwhelmed by how many people he has touched, you know. And I would only hope all of us, when it's our day to be disembodied, that we have that kind of energy. Look at how many people are in this room. I mean, it's fantastic. So Bobo, come on in. Come on in, Bobo. Did you meet Bobo, George?
Yeah.
Yeah. You got to turn on your... Oh, here, I know. I think I got to do that. There we go. You should have gotten that link, Bobo. I'll send it again. And we want you as preps, maybe, I don't know. There's so many on. I know Eric here is from New Jersey. One of his friends back from elementary school. He's known him, you know, longer than Bobo. But with gaps, of course, as we all move through life. Yeah, let's see. So. Yeah, I know we're all trying to hold back the tears. Oh. Bobo, there's an invite. It should. Yeah, I just to keep it together, right? Just keep it together. Oh. Come on in, Bobo. You should see a thing. Hey, I see Sandy's in the room. Suzette, you sent me an awful nice note too. Maybe you want to pop in at some point here. We'd love to. Look at this. Tracy, Cheryl, Catherine from Idlewild back. Look at that. Scott Friedman's in the house also. Love it. Thank you for coming in, Scott. Dick, we're gonna get to you. Oh man. Yeah. Bobo, are you having any problems there? Go ahead and just type in the comments there if you're having technology problems. You've got an invite. How do you know? You guys know how it. I've never had the invite, so it was it appear in the chat, George? How did that work for you? So people know.
I didn't get anything. It's just I popped on the screen. So you,
it popped
you
up like as a pop-up
on your end. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it should have popped up on your screen there, Bobo. We'll see. If we don't see him in a minute, maybe I'll bring in Eileen.
Also, there was, when you were ready to bring me in, the blank, I got kicked out. I don't know why there was a big exclamation mark. And so there are technical glitches here.
Well, yeah. This.
Yeah, which means Jeff would laugh and say, hey, we got time for another glass of wine.
Oh, that's exactly right. You know, it's funny because when we did our he was the third guest on this webcast. Now I've done 37 of these since and with people from all over the world. But Jeff was almost the reason why, you know, he was on my podcast, as I mentioned earlier, back in 2016. So were you, George, by the way. And good to go back and listen to those. But, you know, with him living in Ecuador and in this crazy okay, Eileen, you need to turn on your camera, upper left corner. There's a little blue icon, so kind of left of center. There she is. Eileen, welcome to the Journeys webcast tribute to this legend.
I think I could be wrong, but I think I'm the only woman in NSA who ever trekked with Jeff. Lots of guys, but I think I'm the only woman who ever did it. And George, you put me away. And Vince, oh my God, it's So they just wanted to say one of the, just something quick, because you have many people want to speak. One of the things that we enjoyed so much about Jeff was his spirit of playfulness, but his playfulness with music. And when we were together, whether it was in India, and I will tell you one quick story about India, or whether it's in Ecuador, all of a sudden something would happen and it would be like the first line of a song. I don't know whether we had Vulcan mind meld or what, but suddenly we'd go, oh, did it. And we both start singing this crazy song. And it just, it doesn't matter. It could have been, you know, Bruce Springsteen. It could have been something from a Broadway hit. It was like, oh, we were musically blended. And in fact, I do want to show you, this is a mala. I've had this since 2007, or maybe it was six, when we went with Jeff and crew to trek the northwestern quadrant of the Indian Himalayas, as they say. Dick Plush was on the call. Dick got these for all of us. And to this day, every morning, I chant and meditate with this mala. So you figure out how long that has been. But one of the wonderful adventures when we went to India was that Ankit, who you mentioned, George, Ankit and crew had found out that the Dalai Lama was going to be in a remote monastery. So instead of us going further up the mountains, we had to wait and seek special permission to be able to go to Spiti, where the Dalai Lama would be holding court. Spiti is this remote, arid, high region. To get there, once we finally got permission, our Jeep was hit by a rock slide going down, but we got across. We got across the river. And here we are, probably the only Anglos with villagers who had come from wherever, because this was so unusual for the Dalai Lama to show up. And we're sitting underneath a parachute silk tent out in the courtyard of the monastery, breaking bread with the villagers who, unlike what you see in Delhi, they're not in silks and saris. They're in heavy woolens, kind of like your hat, George. You remember they would wear that heavy hat because it snows 8 months out of the year. The Spiti is closed down. And so here we are it was August. Anyway, all of a sudden, you could see coming up the valley, this monstrous rain cloud. I mean, it was black. And the wind started blowing. And all of a sudden, the rain is pouring down. And you know, they said, you have to leave because you will not get across the rivers if you don't leave now. So we go tearing out from that tent. And we get in this, you know, you're soaking wet. And you get in this Jeep. And Jeff said, well, it never rains in Spiti Valley. I said, oh, yeah, it never rains in Spiti Valley until you've met the Dalai. Then it pours, then it pours. And whenever that we found out, wherever the Dalai Lama went, he brought rain, because rain was perceived as a blessing.
And cleansing, I guess, right? It's a cleansing.
Don't know. They just said it was a blessing. So that's just the thing I wanted to share with you, is this wonderful Jeff-ism. And now I will go off, unless you want to say anything or ask any questions. Or we got up to 16:05.
I wanted to ask you real brief, you know, just share like your first, like how you met Jeff and how how he infected you, like he's done all of us.
It sounds like he's the plague. No. I met Jeff at NSA, and you always knew he was different than the traditional NSA person. And from the time I met him, I liked him because he wasn't a three-piece suitor. You know, he wasn't full of pomp and circumstance. No offense to my NSA buddies who might be on there. And we just hit it off. And every time I'd see him, he called me Eileenie. And we would just, you know, we would laugh and giggle and joke. And I remember meeting Jaffe when they started dating. He brought her to, I think it was Palm Springs, when we had a conference in Palm Springs. And you can't meet Jaffe without instantly loving her. We were unable to make it down to the wedding. But when Jeff would come up with these crazy trips, he would send me an email and he'd say, what do you think? You guys want to do this? And I'd look at my bill and go, time for an adventure. And what's interesting is I'm going to be doing an interview for someone called The Fourth Act. That's on this coming Wednesday. And this way of adventure is just really struck with me. When my mom died in 2012, one of her last things that she said coherently, when I thought I would go away just a little bit, she said, I'll go with you. Let's be daring. Let's have an adventure. And so I think part of my fourth act is I need to find more adventures. But they are prompted. The catalyst is to thinking how Jeff brought adventures. And one other thing that I guess I'd like to note, and you can tell by the comments that are in Facebook, you can tell by the people that are here, Jeff made every person feel as if they were the most important people in his life.
Yeah.
So let's see.
I've just sent an invite to Christian. I'll bring him in while we finish our talk here, Eileen. Yeah. Yeah, and when you and I first met and we connected over NSA and initially I hadn't yet been connected with Jeff, but you and I had such a bond as well, and have loved your spirit, and to see that, you know, not long after that, you and Jeff had that connection as well. It's just, it's amazing how I call it like the warp and woof of a large tapestry where we are all connected. And you just don't always know it, but it does find you. And he found us and we found him. And that's the.
That's it. That's it, Alan. And I think you're a free spirit, you know, getting on that motorcycle and, you know, going all over the world. And we've drank, whatever, wine together. We've done that.
Plenty.
And, yeah.
Yep.
But
you're just waiting for me to get the sidecar. Only if I could convince your husband to let me bring you along.
Well, I got to tell you, when we went to the Himalayas, when Jeff found out how old Bill was, he said, well, he can't go. I said, yes, he can. He said, well, he's too old. And I think he was like 68, maybe 67. And I said, you wait. And sure enough, I have a picture of Bill and Jeff finally at the top of when we got to 16,500. They're both having beer bottles and laughing at each other as they're clinking them. So, yeah.
That's great.
That's great. So should I go off so you can bring in Christian?
Yeah, Christian, go ahead and turn on your microphone. There he is.
Thank you.
Yes, hey, Eileen, thank you.
You're welcome.
I love you, man. Thanks. Awesome. Okay. Christian.
Hey.
You are the one who called me with the news, and you know, it was late morning on Wednesday, and I couldn't, you remember, I couldn't, I just, you asked me, are you still there? You know, did the connection go down? You know, I found some words since then, but I take a moment and I think about it, that I'll never be able to laugh with him or even at him. So I'd like you to share with how you first were, I call it infected or maybe inspired, whatever.
So let's get this out of the way first.
All right, let's do this. Cheers. Here's to you and to Jeff.
And we got that going.
Oh, you got the candle.
And then don't forget this. You're one step behind.
You know what? As this says.
Yeah, perfect.
So thanks for coming in.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I appreciate it. It was a rough week. First, I wanted to say hi to the family, Kate. Yes, she and Jack, Lisa. I told you I was trying to hold it together, but fuck.
I know.
And there's a big part of me that didn't even want to do this today.
I understand. There was a couple friends of Jeff that you and I we knew each other, but I've been in touch with so many people that I didn't know, you know, I hadn't yet had a chance to know through Jeff, and I've had several emails with saying I'd like to do it, but I don't know if I can really do it. So there will be a replay for this, so people can kind of come on. But
well, it was a matter of acknowledging and respecting and honoring.
Yeah. I mean, it was my way. And I look forward to when this doesn't become virtual.
Yeah.
You know, when we do this in person, and I can, you know, and those of us, I hope everybody's getting vaccinated. We can hug again. God, I mean.
So I think out of a lot of just friends and one of the newer ones and, consummate teacher, consummate trickster, joker. And just full of love. And, you know, I've known him less than a decade. The men's group with you and Eric, Larry, you know, Mike, Michael Saul, Brian Smith, Paul Brenner, priceless. And
priceless.
He was the ringmaster. It was his fucking circus. We just all showed up.
Sitting on the floor in that cool little cottage that they, you know, made so warm with, you know, that little slideshow I had at the very beginning. If those of you see it with the, you know, you just the artifacts.
Yeah,
the spirit.
It was just all love, and you know, I was so grateful to get to know him and spend nights at their house. I feel so adopted. I have great parents. I love them to death, but you know, you're never too old to have another parent and a mentor and a friend. I don't want to stay long, but you know, that's the second worst phone call I've had in my life. And as soon as Lisa was on there, I just had to pull over. And then get my shit together. Because Lisa needed some support. And I had to call 6 to 8 other people and give them the news. You're one of them. And most everybody was just very, very quiet for being a bunch of speakers. You guys suck. And, you know, the pain just makes you know how much it mattered. And I'm grateful, so grateful to have time with him. I'll bring it home now. So yesterday, on short notice, my wife and I, Tara, got invited to go out to Joshua Tree. And all I could think of is like, yeah, I didn't know I was going to Joshua Tree. I mean, Integratron, but what would Jeff do? And you just go. And yesterday was like this epic day of microdosing that became macrodosing, plant medicine, and hiking around, you know, Joshua Tree and going to the Integratron. And then we went to Pioneer Town and, you know, we ended up spending the night out there that we'd not planned to do because no one should have been driving home. And it's just about living life. And, you know, Jeff always embodied living life, period.
It's exactly what he did. His as you know, you know, he is one of the people who, as a speaker, you know, he, of course, that's his business, but that is what he believed. His the importance of finding adventure. And I always like to say it's, you know, getting out your comfort zone. He was a guy who just knew that is not just something you do occasionally. That is how you live life. And that is adventure. And when we talked about, and it's funny because I looked at the transcript, but kind of the description of that podcast I did in 2016, and it had the same theme of our webcast, and that is finding adventure in everything you do. And the consistency, he was just so consistent. And I think, you know, was it George, Eileen, Vince? I mean, I can't keep track of all this that said that George, that Jeff had a way to make you feel like you were the most important person in his life. And that is, that overshadows so much. And that's the generosity of giving somebody your time.
Yeah. And when he was present with you, he wasn't someplace else. He wasn't on a phone. He wasn't paying attention to somebody. He was totally present to who you were.
Yeah, he wasn't on his device looking, you know. Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, I want to leave space for others. Carl,
yes.
Alan, thank you so much for making this happen. I love you, buddy.
Thank you, Christian, for bringing. I love you. Come on into the room. I see that Bobo is having some Stephen Shapiro is on. Wow. Thank you, Stephen. Wonderful person. George says, when you decide what to wear in the morning, choose wild colors. Ken, can you get that on? Or are you in darkness? Let me bring you some light. Let me bring you some Jeff. You know, technology is always one of those crazy things. Well, you know. It's famous. If for those of you who were on the webcast a year ago, when I had Jeff on, when he was in Ecuador, you may remember that that the technology. Well, it was more of a ineptitude on my part that we had some technology issues, and then that led to some for Jeff. Jamie Wagner, I'm going to bring you in while Ken works on that. Jamie Wagner's in the room. There's a little icon to turn your camera on. Show how it's done. Up in the upper left, kind of left of center. There he is. Hi, Jamie.
So, hey there. I went to San Diego State, and Jeff's class was called Recreation and the Leisure Experience. And it was a big lecture hall full of about 300 people. And it was a general education class, and I had no idea what I was getting into. And I met this wild guy who talked about his adventures, and it really kindled that curiosity in me about, like, what do I want to do? I started off as an aerospace engineering major, and I became an anthropology major. You know, total life changer for me to have met him. He talked about being a kid from New Jersey who went to Prescott College, and kind of as a field trip, he went to South America and had this, with no equipment, no training, said, I'm going to climb a mountain that's never been climbed, Fitzroy. And just, you know, like getting, not having climbing ropes, this is before adventure travel, just setting off across crevasses with very little preparation, very little equipment, and trying to do what was literally impossible for him at the time. And as an older man, he tried to do Fitzroy again. I had so many experiences with Jess that are just priceless for me. I got to, you know, meet his parents. I got to go with him into Baja California and go to Rancho San Luis, a little place he had with Lydia and Chato and their dog Romero. I got to climb Picacho del Diablo in Baja. I went to Nepal with him. I think it was his first Nepal trip with a group. And just so many priceless memories. You know, like some of the adventures he talked about was not knowing anything about horses, going to South America, I think Argentina, and buying horses and becoming a, you know, kind of seeing gauchos and say, I want to ride like the gauchos, you know. And just like he said, that there were so many blankets on the horse that it was like square, like a big refrigerator. He said it was like sitting on top of a square refrigerator, you know. And I just I'm trying to, you know, he went away for a year from San Diego, and I did too. I went to Japan as an exchange student. I came back and I said, I want to be one of your teaching assistants that were called Kiva leaders, and he let me do that for Kiva. Kiva leaders. Yeah, there were, I think he had it divided into 12. So of the 300, I think they divided this into 12 groups. I think it was done by months of the year of birth. I'm not sure how it was divided, but I'm pretty sure there were 12 of us, and I'm pretty sure we got that 12th of the 300, and we met with those people, and they wrote journal entries, and we kind of graded them. Pretty much everybody got an A if they did any work at all. He encouraged us to take our Kiva groups on adventures, and I took them on a adventure into Baja California, and we had a great time together. Just trying to think. I just feel like it really set me, you know, like his way of adventure became in some ways my way of adventure, you know, and I just so am grateful for that early launch, and just kind of, if a kid from New Jersey could do it, I could do it too, you know, that sort of thing where just, you know, really being a suburban kid kind of saying, I there's adventures out there to be had, and I've traveled over, you know, almost 40 countries now, and just so much of the, I think my desire to see the world, and partly came from that experience. And also, you know, I think as Jeff traveled more and more, part of what he came back with was, you know, stories of his adventures, but also the realm to be explored is really the one within, you know, who am I? How do I fit in the world? How do I contribute? And I think that's been a constant refrain for me, and that's something that I learned from Jeff early on. So many gifts, so much gratitude, and I'm very, very sorry to hear of his death. It's a real loss to me, and I think so many others.
Yeah, for sure. You mentioned that, what it means inside, and he was famously, you know, called it an inventure, you know, and that was so true, you know, and that live adventurously.
So I'll yield to others. I just think of him. I think the thing that I really take is, like, even with very little preparation, you can have a bold goal and set out for it. You know, he did the gaucho thing. He went to Mongolia, was chased by Chinese police. You know, just all sorts of things that were literally outrageous to go into a communist country with authoritarian rule and just going, I'm going to go have an adventure, and, you know, with horses, with the Mongolians, and go for it. So
And he did get thrown in jail in China, and that story he shares on my podcast. And it's just I had just come back from China when I interviewed him on that. I had ridden my motorcycle from, you know, north to south to the Vietnamese border, but I had dreamed of going to the west of China, which where he was, you know. Jamie, thank you so much for sharing.
Yeah, thanks for giving me the chance. And I just wish Jeff's spirit and soul is blessed, and anybody who knew him would be blessed from that experience too.
His light still shines as I have with my
mentor. In me and others. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Eric.
Ken, you know, we got Jamie. Ken, you still need to turn on your camera but meanwhile, we've got one of Jeff's schoolmates going way back to West Orange, New Jersey. Oh my, Ken. I'm so glad that you reached out and shared some of your stories with me, and I can't wait to hear what you have to say.
Yeah, well, I want to thank you for having this, and I want to thank all of you people for enriching Jeff's life after he went out in the world. But, you know, I knew Jeff first in the seventh grade, which is we all did at one point. Had seventh grade, that is. And, you know, as I hear everybody talking about all of his wonderful qualities, which were truly genuinely, and they were the man, you know, he had those qualities way back. You know, the puns, the cleverness, the impishness, the pranks, the adventures. It was always fun to be around him because he would drag that kind of stuff out of anyone he was with. So, he was sort of instant karma kind of thing. And I'd like to talk about some of his exploits. You know, one of the things that we all know about Jeff was the dude was fearless. I mean, fearless. I mean, the small things and the large things, you know, nothing stopped him. For example, one day he found a can of whale blubber at the ShopRite, the local supermarket, brought it home, couldn't wait to open and eat it.
It was terrible. But like nothing was holding me back, you know. I remember once we went to see a friend play at a concert in some college in New Jersey, and there was an antenna wire hanging down the corner of some brick building. And all of a sudden he's climbing up the thing. It gets about 20 feet up, the wire breaks, down into the bushes. But you know, nothing would stop him. Everything from you know, climbing Mount Fitzroy and attempting a second time, and there he took his famous trip on Lake Titicaca, didn't know how to sail. Wasn't necessarily a roadworthy vessel. And, you know, that was Jeff. Another one, one day I was in the Grand Tetons, I was sitting at the visitor center, and I saw this yellow school bus go by from an outfit called Trailside. Now, Trailside had a ski camp in Vermont that was quite popular. And, but I knew that summer Jeff was going to be taking a busload through the kids, full of kids, all through the West doing, you know, outdoorsy stuff. And so I see the Trailside bus go by. I go running across the street to the park headquarters, and there's Jeff talking to some ranger, and I think the guy was giving him a hard time. Anyway, so I go, I wouldn't let that guy into your park, no matter who he is. And so Jeff, like, turned in real anger. You know, I didn't know what was going on, you know, but anyway, he said, oh, it's you, you know, like, he didn't expect to see me, of all people, his buddy from West Orange, there in the Grand Teton. So we had this really loud reunion. Hey, how you doing? Anyway, it later turns out that he had completed a solo climb of a mountain in the Tetons without permission, and they don't allow solo climbing in the national park. And he first they didn't believe he'd done it. Then he showed his logbook that had all the time points and vistas and things, and he convinced him he did it and said, good, you can never climb here again. So he was, in fact, trying to negotiate his way back in their good graces. And last thing he needed was me coming along saying, don't let this guy in. It was pretty funny in retrospect. Let's see. I remember one time, you know, he was boundless energy, right? One time we spent the entire day tramping around in the woods near our house and our houses. And, you know, and around 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon, he said, well, I got to go home because I'm going to the Palisades and climbing the Palisades. And I was tuckered out. He was ready to go for another major, major thing and climb up these sheer basalt cliffs along the Hudson River. That's what the Palisades are. So that was definitely cool. Another one of his stunts is, you've probably all heard this, it might have been in his book, I can't remember, but he basically decided to go camping in Disneyland, in Adventureland. And he would like, you know, as the park was closing, he'd manage to get in at the very last guy in the park. And then he'd hop a fence, and he was sort of like the wild man of Adventureland, and they couldn't track him down. They knew he was there. You know, this is before video security and things. Anyway, they'd catch him, and they'd take him out on the famous golf cart ride out of the park, and he'd be back the next day. And so, anyhow, this was one of his first published pieces. It was published in the Newark Evening News, or maybe the Newark Sunday News. My mother sent me a copy, you know. Even my parents loved Jeff. You know, they didn't really like most of my friends, but they loved Jeff. He was the kind of, how could you not love him?
How could you not? Yeah.
How could you not? You know, his whole career as a motivational speaker was just a packaging of himself. He didn't invent himself to be that. He could entertain, delight, and educate all at once, and he had these wonderful perspectives, and he is the only guy who knew more verses to the Castro convertible sofa commercial than I did, for which I've always been impressed, you know. So, hey, you know, I can go on and on, but Yeah. We all knew the dude, and I just want to leave you with to inveigle you not to forget a line that I gleaned from his book, Aim Higher Than Everest.
Aim Higher Than Everest.
I'm sure if you ever get there, we know who'll be there waiting for you. It'd be Jeff.
Yeah.
He's all around us. We love him. And I hope that will propel us all, because we come here to rejoice knowing him and his life.
Peace, cheers, brothers. That, buddy. Thank you.
I'm done.
All right. Thank you, Eric, so much. We're going to go ahead. Suzette.
Hey there.
Come into the room. Let's see. There we go.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. So real quick, I know a lot of people want to speak, but I used to work at AT&T, and I was responsible for hiring speakers for these really big meetings. And I really wanted to shake it up a little, because we were getting some pretty boring speakers over the years. And so I found Jeff, and I was like, okay, a couple thousand people are about to have their minds blown, because he brought the Tibetan Wheel of Life with him. He talked about, you know, finding your own adventure. People did not know what had hit them, but everybody loved him. And he had everyone in the palm of his hands, all these corporate types, and they were all just loving him. And he and I became friends as part of that process. And we ended up bringing him back again. And he taught us about how you don't always reach your goals. He told us the story of when he tried to climb that mountain again for his friend, and he just had to tap the mountain because he wasn't going to make it. And there wasn't a dry eye in the room. There were thousands of corporate types sitting there crying. And he and Jaffe were just rays of sunshine. And I have this, one of my favorite pictures is sitting on their sofa in Encinitas, and it's just pure joy emanating from that photograph. And I met so many people through him, Trisha and Jaffe and Dick and Randy and Bruce and so many people. And I'm sure a lot of them are on this call. I know Dick is. You know, when I'm sitting there working late one night, and I get this email from him, and it says, hey, you know, I'm trying to pilot this new thing called the Inner Peak Experience. Are you interested in helping me out? And I'm like, he's like, what we're going to do is we're going to climb this mountain, and then we're going to rappel off this thing called Suicide Rock, and then we'll just do all this other stuff. And I'm like, yes, let's do it. So I got on an airplane, and I just went out there, and I was like, trust Jeff, you know, everything was just trust Jeff. And then we went to Costa Rica, and Jaffe was doing this whole like yoga and meditation retreat, and we had such a ball there. And you know, I miss him like I miss a piece of my arm. You know, like I can't imagine. He died on my birthday, and I didn't find out till the next day from Dick, and I was just shocked. But I wanted to say my condolences to his family. He loved his family so much. And I love him dearly. And I love all of the people that are part of this group for just knowing him and sharing things about him. So Suzette, cheers to you, Jeff.
Yeah, cheers to you, Suzette. Thank you. I love you, man. Guys. Thank you for coming on. Your email was so kind. Speaking of Dick. Okay. You know, I had to do a workaround to get Bobo into the room. So it looks like Bobo is Jeff, but this is Bobo. Go ahead and turn your camera on, Bobo. That icon. We did this. We did a little test.
God. There is a God.
I am so sorry for the difficulty. I don't know why you couldn't get in with the other link, but, but you're here. It's all that matters.
Let's not even go into that.
Yeah.
But I've
cheers. Do you have a scotch or something going? What's going on?
I've got smart water for a dumb computer person. Anyway.
Well, cheers to you. Thank you.
I didn't quit. I almost threw my laptop through a window.
Yeah. Just come a little closer to the mic, because
almost threw my laptop through a window.
Well, I'm glad you didn't, because you have known Jeff perhaps longer than anybody on this call. You know obviously Erica had gone to school with him, but for so many years you guys were connected. I know that you I want to get into it a little bit, because you went to him on a, oh yeah, your microphone went off.
How about now?
You're on.
Okay, great. I figured it out.
Just give me a little more gain. Just give me a little more gain.
Testing 1, 2. How's that? That's all I got.
Okay, you're good. Okay. So look, you not only have been on the treks with him, you kind of partnered with him on some really crazy trips and enticing and somehow convincing other people to go with you on a, I want to go to Nepal.
People.
Yeah. You went to somewhere where nobody had been for years, right?
Yeah. We, only part of Nepal is open for trekking, and in the West, there's an area called the Dolpo, which is an area made famous by a guy named Peter Matheson. He wrote a book called The Snow Leopard that a lot of people have heard of. It was had a certainly a cult following. And the Dolpo was closed right after Matheson was in there, which I think was 1962 or something like that. And we were over there and we heard it was opening. And so we paid a lot of money and we bribed a lot of people and we got the first trekking permit ever since 1962 to go into that area. And I actually think some of the people that are listening were on that trip, but we took 7 people telling them, we can't guarantee your safety. We can't guarantee anything. We're gonna go see the Dolpo. And if you'd like to come up with us, we'd love to have you, but we just don't know what's gonna happen. And it was just incredible experience.
Yeah, so what happened when you got up there? I mean, you know, you're going to the Dolpo, first people going in, you got Snow Leopard is ingrained in you. You know, it's one of those great novels of the or great adventure stories of the 70s, 80s. I don't know when that came out, but here you are. I mean, maybe the first gringos. I'll use the word gringo. I know that's not what they say.
Yeah. You know, they'd never seen white people before, and you know, they thought we were from the moon. And you know, we had things like sunglasses on and colored clothing, and you know, the people there were just wearing rags. Actually, the first thing we noticed is that none of them spoke Nepalese. And Jeff and I and our other partners at the time, we all spoke pretty good Nepali, and these guys didn't, so we had to look around for a long time to find somebody over there that spoke their dialect and Nepalese so they could translate for us. So we found a guy named Casey who was a real rascal, and he spent the next month and a half with us. But yeah, we got way more snow than we thought we would encounter. We had people come out of their houses and throw rocks at us, not knowing what we were or where we were. They didn't think they lived in Nepal. They would say, no, Nepal is way, you know, Uta, way over there. And we would go in these houses of people that had no possessions whatsoever. They had a copper cook pot and often some kind of bag or backpack or more like a giant purse that would just go over one arm. And that was their entire possessions. And it was wild. I'd spent a lot of time in Nepal with Jeff and never seen people living this basic of life. It was incredible.
So I want to kind of dig in a little bit to this because I'm looking at some comments that have been going on, but you know, trust Jeff. Mary, who's on the call, said to Suzette, you know, which is something that you know, that's Suzette said, and also what George said. Uh-huh. And, you know, because, you know, you may be going into an area like this Dolpo, or you're going to Sikkim, and you're not a mountain climber. You've maybe never even traveled before to these kinds of wacky places. But you guys got a little bit challenged with the snow up there. And this wasn't, you know, I mean, you know, they always say that the adventure starts when things stop going as planned. Mm-hmm. And I'd love you to share this story about the doctor.
Oh, God. Okay.
And the snowstorm.
Well, good. You know, we used to always say really, really good adventure sucks while it's happening. It's a year later over a campfire and a glass of scotch that
that they make for the best stories. But, you know, we had way more snow than we had planned on. The goal was to get to the Crystal Monastery, Che Gompa. And we got within a day of it, but we turned around at waist-high snow. All the Westerners were equipped for it, but we had about 30 porters and maybe a dozen Sherpas with us, and they were not equipped for it. You know, a lot of guys walking barefoot in the snow, which they actually prefer for the grip. And again, their feet don't look like ours. They're really wide and really, really thick callus, and they laugh at us, complaining about our cold toes and the boots, and you know, they're wearing an old pair of tennis shorts. But anyway, side story. We left the idea of going to Che Gompa. We turned around at Foxindo Lake, which readers of the book will know about. And we headed for Jumla, where we were supposed to get picked up by an airplane. And we get to Jumla, and there's 3 feet of snow on the airstrip. And so we hire the whole village of about 150 people to shovel a place in the airstrip where a airplane could land. And these are the little de Havilland Twin Otters that seat about a dozen people or so. And right as we're, you know, we didn't do the whole airstrip, but maybe 30 feet wide by 150 feet long, just the amount needed. Right as we're ending, we hear that the plane is in the air and it's going to come get us. And right as we're the last shovelfuls of snow, it starts snowing again. And, you know, we hear the planes turning around, and just it dumped another 3 feet on us. And we're stuck in one room. There were, I guess, 7 clients and Jeff and I, so probably 9 of us in like a 10 by 10 room. And a whole variety of reactions from people wanting to go hike out on their own and cross a mountain range and, you know, get out on their own, to, you know, the one guy that drove everybody crazy, just putting us over the top crazy. But there was one day where the sun came out and the roofs in the village of Jumla were flat. It looked kind of like the Taos Pueblo. And to get up on a roof, they had these little rickety ladders, and we could look out the window and the sky was blue and the people were up on their roofs. So we all came out of the one room and we went up on the roof. They're very close to each other, maybe 10 feet or so. And they have to shovel all the snow off the roofs because the snow will saturate the mud on the roof and make it leak. So, you know, they're not set up with a steep slanted roof. So we go up there, and what happens is an entire village snowball fight starts. All of us just, and, you know, hundreds of people in a very small area just throwing snowballs at each other and laughing and carrying on. And we had one guy, Dave Beck. I hope you're watching, Dave. And he was the only doctor that we had on board. He was from UCLA Medical Center. And he goes to walk down this ladder, and he's got gaiters and big hiking boots, you know, snow caked on the boots. And it's a real rugged ladder. And from about 7 or 8 feet up, he just slips and does, I think it's called a gainer, where it's kind of a backflip. And he lands just right on his shoulder and his head. I was right behind him. And he broke his collarbone terribly. I've seen other broken collarbones, but Dave had this giant bump, you know, on the, and he couldn't speak. He was just in a tremendous amount of pain. And, you know, I had emergency medical background, but nowhere near equipped to deal with Dave. You know, we had some Valium and some hashish. You know, trying to calm him down, trying to get him so he could eat. And
so the only doctor in the group takes an injured
endo. Yeah. So Jeff and Gombu hear that there's a leprosy clinic up a canyon about 5 miles. So they take off up in the snow, find these 2 nuns, Scottish nuns up there. And they said, oh yeah, painkillers. We have morphine. We have heroin. You know, tell us what you want. So they come back with morphine and, you know, give Dave a shot after day 4. And by then the snow was starting to melt and we were able to get a helicopter to come
take Dave and I out while Jeff stayed with the group, and we were able to bribe the Nepali military to send a bigger helicopter for them and get them out the next day.
Wow.
Yeah.
So great story. Let's go back, you know, and then we'll get on some. I you know, being the most long term. By the way, this is Dar. Okay, she found me about the time maybe Jeff found me, mm-hmm. and Jeff would bring Tupita, the dog, over to my house, and Dar and Tupita kind of got along slowly, mm-hmm. but yeah, that's it. So George, by the way. George was asking about my cats because George knows that. Anyway, when did you first meet him and you guys connected and ultimately entered into this kind of partnership where you were leading these tours not only to the wacky places of the Dolpa, but also Baja California?
Baja California, China, Thailand, you know, all over the place. I met Jeff on his 24th birthday at San Diego State where bunch of people were going out drinking after a class, and I was 18 and he was 23 turning 24, and
you weren't drinking at this point in your life though, of course, right?
Oh no. You know, they were giving me a stealth glass under the table, but you know, in those days I think the people didn't care as much as they do now. We were at Two-Bit Sandwich Shop next to San Diego State, if anybody remembers that, and a pitcher of Old Milwaukee Dark was $2. So we met then, and I became a teacher's assistant in his class.
Okay.
He had a group called the Bujum Institute that was running outdoor weekend adventures at the time, and I became an intern there. And we just, you know, we just became friends after that. And friends turned into roommates, and roommates turned into best men at weddings, and you know, we were partners.
And I know because you and I chatted before, and you and I, we've probably met maybe at one of those
I'm sure we did.
Adventure 16 speaking, or at his house as I was there for that sale as well as you. You saw the photos earlier, you know, so I know that you know, Jeff's son, Jacinto, a.k.a. Jack, and you also have a son. And I thought what you shared with me was really interesting because we were talking with George earlier and how the next generation, how the Saul's energy is not going to just, nor the Bobo energy, and the connection, the Saul's Bobo, is not going to end.
Survive both of us. We have two boys who were within 11 months of age of each other. They're both graduating college next week. They're both getting degrees in film production. You know, they both grew up together. We have this ranch that I had mentioned to you in Baja. Jeff and I and about five other people own about 4,000 acres, about 45 miles below the border. And, you know, these boys were in, they were climbing rocks in their diapers and bare feet, you know, before they could talk.
Wow.
And, you know, we're getting old and we don't go down as much as we used to. And, you know, they're going to take it over someday and hopefully have it live.
Yeah. On. That connection Sarnowski.
Sarnowski.
Sarnowski, Saul's relationship will be the next generation. Hey, I want to thank you, Bobo, and I'm sorry about all the technical.
I've seen Jacinto and Yeshi every day since Jeff's passing.
Oh, how are they doing?
And that's what I wanted to add. They're what a couple of incredible kids. They're doing great. You know, we're all doing great. It's just really sad, but you know, none of us ever picture Jeff as a 92-year-old man in diapers and a walker. You know, that you think about it, that just doesn't work. So we always knew he'd go out in a blaze of glory somehow, sometime, but I didn't think it would be COVID in this young. And we're crying a lot and hugging each other, and it's just been beautiful.
We need the hugs. I'm so glad that you're there with
with the kids.
Yeah.
I haven't seen either. I mean, I'm obviously, but you're obviously very close, and
we're all family.
Yeah. And I look forward to the in-person memorial. You know, this is just the teaser for that.
You know, I was talking to Kate just before your webcast started, though, and with COVID, we don't know if we can gather with 200 to 300 people like we'd like to. So it might be, you know, I mean, we're just starting to talk about it, but it might have to be some sort of virtual event. I've had hundreds, literally hundreds of people, 50, 60 out of state people saying they're coming for it. And, you know, we just lost one guy to COVID. I don't think we can gather with 300 of us.
Yeah. I got my second jab today, by the way, which is just ironic, you know, something that Jeff was unable to.
I did hear that Lisa will be here at the end of May.
So well, that's we'll good news. And I wanted to remind everybody, there is that GoFundMe page. I know somebody mentioned that they were having a problem with that link. I'll go check that. Maybe since you sent me that link, and once I bring in Ken here, you could go into the chat and post the link in the chat just as a backup.
Yeah, well, we just saw how good I am at computer stuff. So I'll do my best.
Well, I know you're a hell of a musician.
On a mountain, I'm great. On a computer, I'm absolutely terrible.
On a mountain, but I also understand on the guitar you're pretty good. And just one last thing. One of the things that I didn't know as much about Jeff, and others probably did, but I do remember like once or twice him just pulling the harmonica out at the Encinitas Cottage. But he actually performed with you a little bit.
Hundreds of times. You know, hundreds of times. He played a real... He had these giant harmonicas. It wasn't the little blues ones. It was these big things. And he'd play this Oompa Oompa style. And we would sing old Wailing songs and Gary Jeff Walker songs. And it was just you know, we were very silly together. And it was just fun to go into a crowd of people and try to make everybody act like morons also. And we would all find great joy and love in our moronosity. And I'll miss him a lot. He's going to leave a big hole in our community.
Well, you know, I love you for our shared connection.
Thank you. And we'll have to tip a glass someday live.
We're going to do that. And maybe we'll even get the guitars out, you know. Maybe you can show me something because, you know, I'm a hack. But you know, it's like Eileen was saying before, you know, music is something that connects people as well as food and drink and energy, for sure.
Music is what love sounds like, is what
Amy said. So I'm glad we finally got you in.
And I click off here somehow?
Yeah, I'll click you off. And then we've got Ken Dykewald.
Ken, nice to meet you. I've heard your name a million times, but we've never met.
Love listening to your stories.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll talk soon, Bobo. I'll do that. You know, Ken, I thought I never met you, but now that I see you, since you finally got your camera working, I have a great photograph of you. I didn't put it on that slideshow, but it was at that, and I don't know if you remember meeting me, but at that sale, there's a great photo, and send me your email after of you and Jaffe. Sadly, Jeff's not in that photo, but it is a very warm photo of you two. But thanks for tuning in and being so patient with the technology. How did you know Jeff? And
I've got two things. I know there's tons of interesting and wonderful folks on this call, and let me first say that I'm really kind of blown away by all of you guys that have been talking, just the stories and the colorfulness and what you shared with Jeff and being in crazy places, doing crazy things. The heartbeat of Jeff is in all of you. I'm really kind of amazed by that. But let me share with you two tiny little tidbits. One is a message from Jeff, but I'm going to save that for a second. The first is, I was in Mexico this morning celebrating Deborah Zeke, the founder of Rancho La Puerta's 99th birthday in a mariachi festival that we held for her. So I didn't know about Jeff passing until I got a message and I'm home and I'm on this call. So I haven't even really digested all this, but It's got to be somewhere around 25 years ago. I'm a Jersey boy originally. I kind of tuned in, turned on, dropped out, left Jersey for Big Sur in 1970. And about 25 or so years ago, I get a call from a friend of my parents, Herb Gladstone, who says to me, I've got a nephew who we worry about. And he thinks he'd like to be a public speaker, but he's a little bit unusual. Would you be willing to give him some guidance? So I spoke to Jeff in an amazing phone call. And I said to him, I'm here in the Bay Area. Why don't you come up when you've got some time and we can kind of bullshit around about how that all works. And he was like a heat seeking missile. He was there the next day. And he was captivated by the idea. And I said to him, like, well, how are you making money now besides being a little bit of a teacher? He says, bartending. And I said, well, there's some money to be made in speaking, but you got to kind of work out your thing and you got to like get an agent and you got to get some clients. And so over the last quarter of a century, I've kind of watched him craft his gig. And is the gig what mattered more to him or the adventure that the gigs allowed him to have? I would say that he was a big-hearted guy. I was thinking when I got this message today that when God was giving out hearts, Jeff got the big box. And man, was he childish. His playfulness. But he was also had this weird streak of courage. I mean, the stuff that he did, I'm listening to, you know. And he also seems like he was a great friend and lover of the people he loved. Now, here's the message from him. 3 weeks ago, I did an event, and in order to be in the webcast, the person had to apply. I wasn't managing it. It was at Esalen Big Sur. And Jeff applied, and there were three questions that each person had to answer. And I'm going to tell you what Jeff's answers were to the questions. The first question was, what are the three values that feel core to your being? And Jeff said, curiosity, kindness, and gratitude. The next question is, what are your favorite practices or personal rituals? And he wrote, chopping water, carrying wood. And then in parentheses, the latter is easier, the former more interesting. And then there was the big question, what in the universe could you simply not do without? And he said, lunch. So I share that with you, messages from Jeff, and I share the love of this man. So wishing you guys all the best. And I think we should turn some of our attention, as you've said. I've just gone to GoFundMe. By the way, I couldn't find it through the link. I went to GoFundMe and I just typed in Lisa's name. And the page came right up, Lisa Jaffe with a space. So I think now we turn some attention to his family. And I would agree with you that this man had a full life. As someone who's interested in longevity, some people live 100 years and don't have much of a life. This guy had more life in a day than most of the people in the world have in a 50-year span. So my love to all of you guys. Be well. Take care of those you care about.
Amen to that. Thank you, Ken. I really appreciate your patience, and I look forward to meeting you again. And send me your email, because I want to send you that photo of you and Jaffe, because it's nice. I've also put while you were talking, I went and corrected the link. So on the offer sidebar, as well as at the very top of the chat, is the proper link for GoFundMe to help Lisa start a new life, because she's obviously lost quite more than we can imagine. So Carla, are you still there? I am. I am throwing a link out to you that you can join the room. Um,
Yeah, there's a lot of notes, and I want to come back. Heather actually was kind enough to point that. Also, Michelle put a shorter version for the link. So if in the chat there are the links. Stephen Shapiro, who it's amazing how, like, just in a day like this, like, Stephen was on my webcast, you know, months after Jeff was, and the fact that he knew, you know, Jeff, yeah, it's just this, it's that warp and woof, you know, how we're that tapestry, how we're all so connected. Wow. I wanted to, I sent you, I can't believe I'm scrolling through. Dick, I want to bring you on. I sent you a invite a little earlier. I don't know if you saw it, but I'm resending that again. I want to get Dick Plush on here, who is mentioned several times as we've been chatting. All of you who I know personally, of course, I met through Jeff, and that story I started to share with George, and that I didn't fully close on, where he was kind of being kind, as he is, and generous with time, but he expected to not let the evening draw out, able to use the excuse that I've got dinner to attend to, we'll see you next time. But he ended up inviting me for that dinner, and then we would stay until way late. And whenever he introduced me to somebody new in his world, he would share the story of how he didn't know if he was going to want to just hang out with me that long, and that it ended up being such a great connection. And you know, I always kind of blushed, if you will, as he shared that story, because it was so kind, and you know, but you could tell when he told it. It was in his heart, you know. He did feel that way, and that's how I repeat that. I think this might be the theme of today's webcast. How Jeff had this ability. Given, look how many people they're still on here. We've been on here for an hour and 49 minutes, and there's still like more than 75 people tuned in. And I thank you for that. I am gonna play the replay here shortly, but we've got a few more minutes. I want to bring anyone else up on here. Go ahead and hit that hand and say you want to talk. I know Carla was here earlier. She may have left. All right, here's Dick. Dick, come on. I don't know if you didn't see my original, but let's get Dick on here. But this is what he did. He had the ability to make you feel you were the most important person in his life. Yet look how many people are on here. How can he make hundreds of people, thousands maybe? I mean, hundreds for sure. For sure. This is absolutely, you know, mind-boggling. Yeah. Yeah. Come on, Dick. Bring it on. I don't know if Michael Shapiro is still here, but I would love to just say hi with you on there if you're open for that. But I love that Spinovich is here, who is a regular on my webcasts from Mexico, who I don't believe knew Jeff. And there's several others, by the way, of people that are regulars on the webcast. Lee Marvin, who never had a chance to know Jeff. Jefe. We call him Jefe, you know? Jefe in Spanish is chief, you know? Although he never looked and saw himself as chief. You saw the little snippet of about losing your ego, leaving it at the door, hanging it on the hook. That was Jeff, you know. He never wanted to see himself as elevated above anything. So, yeah. Crazy. Jefe and Jaffe, there you go. Suzette, great. It's crazy.
You know, it's funny. You see, I've got there's one posted here and some highlighted stuff in Jeff's book. So while Dick gets that link going, I'm not going to read too much, but I just, one of the things that I highlighted that's on this page was, you know, he talks about it, scaling in mountain peaks, and we don't all have to be mountaineers, rock climbers, mountain climbers in order to seek peaks. The peaks that we may seek in life, you know, the summits that we want to assess are not always physical. They can be emotional. They can be spiritual. They can be so many things. So real quick, simple Jeffism, you know, peak experiences are wherever we decide to find them. And that's something to think about, you know, is your peak experience, whether it is achieving something or whether it is the adrenaline, whatever that means, it's what you find. And that comes back to what so many people were saying about Adventure Inside and his whole theme of inventure. Jeff, a memory, a note, or just to kind of check in and share a little, and to grieve together. You know, this is a little, you know, opportunity where we can grieve. And it's so nice that so many of you are still here. I am like, just click that, go through the test. You know, I'm 3/4 into this bottle. I mean, this is a rosé. I'm sorry that, you know, it's always something, right? You know, they always say, when something goes wrong, you know, if it's not one thing, it's 10 things. I guess that's the way I like to say that. That's right. In fact, it's funny. If you listen, Eric, you say, hey, that's part of the adventure. When Jeff and I did our little interview back a year ago in about this time, you know, in April, we did have technology problems. And if you watch that, I stripped out all the awkwardness so you don't have to sit through it. But we do talk about the fact that even technology and solving problems, that's the most amazing part of adventure, is when you can solve the problem, like finding the helicopter, like going to the monastery in order to get help. So I'm sorry, folks, for you tuning in. The light of Jeff is still burning. confuses computers. You can't live with them. You can't live without them. So I'm just reading the comments here. Sorry to be silent. I don't have to fill the space. It's, Emily, thank you. Larry, maybe you can come on. Laura, Jamie's sister, is on. She says she met. Thank you, Laura. You met Jeff tagging along with Jamie on a trip to Baja to the Casa de Lidia. Hi, Lorna. Thank you for tuning in. It's one of the last books surviving. That's awesome. But you say that that the most big, wonderful venture, a spontaneous trip, a trek in Nepal. Adventure it was mostly, but it brought a bigger curiosity to life and to who I am. Jeff shined a light on life, culture, and the gift of just being and walking the land and feeling the people. Smile at the flowers and the kids, not the side of the road. An inspired adventure. Find out about who you are. And when everything is stripped away, Jeff was a gift to us all in gratitude for his light and laughter. Well, Dick says if he doesn't get on, he's been posting stories and pics of Jeff on Facebook. But I wanted to, there's somebody that's on. I don't know if he's still on, but I got so many emails and by many of you who have come on. But this is somebody who didn't feel comfortable come on. This is what he said to me. He says, hey there,
I caught most of that webcast a year ago and have become dear friends with Jeff and Jaffe in the past 4 years together here in Ecuador. I was definitely, he's definitely tuned in. He says, I'm not comfortable being interviewed or any form of public speaking. Never have been. But it was always enlightening and entertaining to watch our Jeff at work. I've seen numerous presentations he had given in his career. So I will gladly join you and the rest of the people he has touched throughout the years. It should be a love fest we'll all remember. And that's it. And this was a note from a woman, Joanne. I don't know if she joined us today or was busy. There were a lot of people that couldn't make it. And she says, hi, Alan. Thank you for organizing this. It is such a shock. Jeff is the essence of life itself. Seems impossible that he could be gone. I've known him for nearly 40 years and Lisa for nearly 30, well before they knew each other. But I had been out of the country myself for 16 years, so not always up to date. On one of my return trips, I realized that they had gotten married, so I went to see them and where they were leaving in Encinitas. So many personal overlaps. So many people whose lives Jeff touched. She knew that there would be a lot of people on here. Well, I tell you what, I am going to go and roll into the replay of this. You're going to love this. I hope you stick around and watch it. I'm going to roll the replay and I'll be here in the chat. We'll keep the chat open and you guys can, continue the conversation, continue the love, continue the light. This is exactly a year ago to the day that we lost Jeff. Thank you. I want to tell you about Jeff Sahls. For those of you online who don't know him, he's an author, adventurer, and anthropologist. He's currently watching and waiting out this coronavirus while sitting on the equator. He earned his PhD in anthropology during a half century of studying wisdom of individuals and cultures while mountaineering and exploring the wildest corner of the planet, including Patagonia, the Amazon, Outer Mongolia, Eastern Siberia, Chinese Turkestan, and the Himalayas of Tibet. A celebrated best-selling author, his book Way of Adventure, which I have right here, shares the secrets of man's resilience to adversity, and it's widely recognized as the definitive book on adventure. He's asked by C-level executive teams at global organizations like Google, Microsoft, Walmart, eBay, and even the Walt Disney Company to turn to him for inspiration as well as training. He's an internationally known television journalist and a frequent host on the Discovery Channel, and he's appeared on the early morning show for CBS as their go-to adventure expert. Today, as you guys all know, in Ecuador, he makes his home in Cuenca, where he continues to live a life of adventure with his lovely wife, Lisa Jaffe. That's our guest today, and he is working hard to get back online, and it looks like he is in the room right now. It is my pleasure I don't know what's going on. There's a lot of noises. He was in the room. We're getting him. Microphone and camera on. This, you know, talk about.
We're back.
Okay, you know the problem here.
We haven't started drinking yet.
Okay, I just read your biography. So Jeff, now that you're on, and I'll tell you, I know you had additional problems that have nothing to do with this. But the problem that when we had everybody in the room and they're saying, hey, are you guys starting? Jeff and I had already been talking for 5 minutes, and I had failed to push the green button, it's just a green button that looks like a phone, which is the wrong button I needed to push to go live.
It's hard to get good help these days. I understand that.
Man, all of this this crazy stuff. So, you know, I'm going to go back and chat.
Well, I want to thank all our viewers, most of whom are family and friends of mine, I see, and the rest are family and friends of yours. Thank you for your patience. Boy, we were hustling and we unplugged and replugged and all the people, my son Jack was calling and it was to help us out. So it's a miracle to, it's a fact that humans are fallible and so is technology, but somehow it came together and thank you for hanging in there.
Interesting. Yeah,
if you're not there, what the heck?
It's still coming. You know, here's the thing. And I had this great little, I don't call it a speech, but I had this kind of, you know, I was talking before, Jeff, as you heard me, but nobody else was because I didn't click the goddamn green button. But I was asking people, how are you feeling, you know, especially in these uncertain times? And I can tell you during that whole debacle where I know that we had a lot of people in the room who had no clue, I'm feeling pretty shitty, to be honest with you. Okay.
You mean at that moment or in your life at this moment? In
that just moment that, of- at that moment of like what happened to Jeff? I can see him, I can't hear him, not pushing the green button. Like I felt like an idiot, you know? And you know, that's got nothing to do with the times of Corona. And it just is like, you know, what are you gonna do? So
my newest friend John Saunders wrote with great wisdom, there's your adventure.
So I just read, you know, I'm going to say this thing again, because I think it was apropos, but even though we all know, I just think that it's a time that when you're not feeling right, like I wasn't feeling right at that moment, is to express yourself, you know, and it's okay not to be okay. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with talking about it. You should cry or otherwise hang your head low. And it's also okay to laugh about it and make jokes. And, an adventure is, and I was just, you know, talking about The Way of Adventure, Jeff, while you were rebooting and doing that, and about it's the definitive book on adventure. And with what your new friend, what was his name?
John Saunders.
I'm going to read something out of your book. Do you mind? Can I use your
book? I like it already.
Okay. And I want to go right into this because I do want to come back to the Chinese jail story that you told us, but nobody was listening because I didn't have the mic on. I mean, I didn't have the thing on. Okay. So this is in Jeff's book. It's under the Scale Your Inner Mountaintop chapter. And I'm just going to read one paragraph because it's apropos for what you just said and what Saunders just said. It says, for some of us, the travel plan of choice includes a trip to the locale where the ice drops away 5,000 feet behind our boot heels. We require the periodic dose of danger, the occasional lumbago with lady luck. For others, personal growth does not require a constant dose of discomfort and repetitive exposure to the wind, the cold, the cranky customs officials. For the adrenaline addicted, I'm the bearer of bad news. Danger may not be adventure's song, but adventure is not necessarily danger. Peak experiences wherever we decide to find them are wherever we decide to find them, even in our backyards. Of course, closer to home, we may actually have to work a little harder to find it.
Oh, that's good. Who wrote that?
My guest today on the Journeys podcast, I'd like everybody to know, Jeff Sauls is here. And yes, I mean, we're in lockdown here. What really is adventure then if it's not adrenaline addicted, if it's not getting on a motorcycle and trying to traverse the, you know, the Namibian desert or the Nubian plains of Sudan?
Well, yeah, adventure in some ways is sort of an artificial construct. We go out to create a sense of excitement and importance and drama in our lives because it doesn't necessarily exist in our more day-to-day life. Well, interestingly enough, I mean, we are right now living, I mean, what could be more adventurous than living on the cusp of history? I mean, we're living in this moment, the greatest adventure anyone alive has ever lived. And as a culture and as an individual, I think, wow, the page is turning. I'm writing that page. This is incredible. We don't have to go. We were locked up, but adventure has really come to us. We don't have to create any artificial. We don't have to go to the Disneyland of the Himalayas or take a pogo stick to cross the South Pole. I mean, just staying at home, locked up, we are making history. And all of our constructs, all of our faith, all of our wisdom is being challenged. And what else is adventure but exactly that?
And to John's point, of course, this was I just went through a crazy adventure. First of all, trying to find you. I don't have your phone number, and I'm trying to help you technically. That was a whole journey in itself, and we're here at the
3 minutes, a whole hero's journey.
That was exactly it. You know, a lot of people. The reason I started this webcast, Jeff, as you know, is to get the idea across that we are all in this together. It's not a cliche. And yet to how perspective can really frame how we survive or how we tackle this or how we just emotionally kind of make sense of it all. And, you know, there's uncertainty, there's fear, there's death, there's all that, but there's also huge headings of desire right now. Desire. Talk about that, how things are changing and how do we adapt and how do we use perspective to kind of take us somewhere?
Well, you say desire, it's hope. We're getting a vision. One reason we climb mountains is we get a perspective on what we ordinarily don't see. We get a more elevated view of what's possible. And I think that's part of, along with the despair, is a desire for something better than before. And it took that sort of craziness of everything falling apart for it to kind of come back together. But we're kind of back together in a heightened state. We're all excited and we're all like not playing host and we're like here. So I think that's what's happening too. We are in a moment where we have been forced to let go of the things we have to let go of the myth of security that we've embraced for so long. I think one problem that we just had was that I think I lost connection. Ecuador, we were watching Netflix last night and we had to stop watching Netflix and go to a book because we lost our internet. And I'm sure it's because of the confusion and chaos which is reigning all over the world. So we're losing the misconceptions we held that the status quo is the way it's always been and must be. And with that comes the vision of what's possible, like the chrysalis. You know, the caterpillar, I didn't know this till recently, doesn't just change shape and become a butterfly. First, it dissolves into this mush of nothingness. Well, I think we're all kind of in a mushy nothingness state in our lockdowns. And from this state of chrysalis, yes, I think we're seeing that we're not just the victims, but we're the protagonists in this amazing novel, which is the novel Corona 19. And we're the authors that can write the outcome as differently and as interestingly and as creatively and positively as we collectively choose.
Yeah. If
that makes any sense.
Yeah, no, amen to that. Here, toast to that here.
Toast to that.
Hey, I'd like to ask all of our guests who finally and were patient, get a glass of wine, a beer, or whatever your vice of choice.
Real adventurers drink scotch, lad. The real adventurer.
I'm drinking a Torrontes. This is from Argentina. There's no really wine made in Ecuador, by the way, but this is not far away. They do grow it in the very southern part of Bolivia on the Argentina border. And this is from Cafayate, or of course, as they say in Argentina, Cafayate. And it is a higher elevation. This kind of grape, white grape, does well there. But that's enough of the wine talk. You're drinking scotch.
Yeah,
I like that.
If you are going to drink wine, Alan, at least drink it out of the bottle. There you go.
This is so true. So you know, coming back to perspective in this. I keep going. You and I chatted the other day as we were talking about what we were going to talk about. And you looked back in that gorgeous room with the nice colors on the wall and Jaffe's artwork, and it's very comfortable. You made a choice and moved to you from your homeland.
Yeah.
To change. And so you're not like, you didn't get stuck there like last week's guests are stuck in Uruguay, and they frankly would love to be getting their way back home. That is your home.
Yeah.
And that's a bit of an adventure there. How did that come back?
Well, I got to say, when I was 19, I first came to South America to climb, and it felt right somehow. The values of community, of a sense of connectedness, the folk culture being so vital, and of course the wild mountains. So I just, you know, dreamt someday I could make it back. And then just a couple few years ago, 3 years ago now, Jack was off to college. Yeshi, my daughter, was about to graduate from college. And I got a note that I had money called Social Security coming my way. And I realized that for the little bit of money I was going to make, I could either work very hard and use that to pay for 3 nights of dinner in Del Mar or live for a year in Ecuador. So I Jaffe and I said, let's just go. And it's the best thing we've ever done. I mean, of course, I miss the kids and I miss my friends. But we walk out the door in the morning and we're in a different world where the beauty of adventure and travel is just being in an environment which is different than what you're accustomed to. Your somnambulism fades. You're more awake. because everything is curious. That's why you tire easily when you travel. You're making 1,000 new decisions and discoveries in a day, you know, many tiny ones and big ones. So we opted, I got to say, for a life of adventure and a life of economy. Life we didn't have to work so much and work so hard to be as happy as we are.
I'm showing a map so people have a perspective of where you are. This is Ecuador and northwestern South America. These are the Galapagos Islands, which are also part of Ecuador. And then I'm going to just kind of zoom in. We'll clear up my thing. This is Cuenca, where that red dot is right here.
I'm waving. If you look real close, you can see me waving.
Yes, yeah, there. And also what you see here, these are the Andean Mountains. And Jeff, where are you? You're sitting at what, about 8 something? What?
8,500, and then we're on the 12th floor of our apartment. So we're, 8,560 or something.
8,560. So yeah. that's pretty tall. And to give perspective, there's the regular map, but I also like to look at how close you are to the this is so to your east is Peru and to your north is Colombia, and all of this area, and this is the Amazon and the Amazon basin. But look how dry it gets. Yeah. I mean, you got this most luscious rainforest in the world, and just hundreds of miles to the west is the driest place on the planet.
Right, Atacama Desert, driest place on the planet. And all through there's remarkable indigenous tribes, the mountain Quechua, the Amazonian Shuar, the Achuar, so many tribes. So to be down here is pretty exciting, because it doesn't take long to get someplace really remarkable. And I'm the adventure travel editor for it's the largest magazine in Ecuador, Cuenca Expats Magazine. So our job is to go out and cause trouble and find remarkable things. So it's very cool.
We all are, as we say, in this together, this Corona thing. And I'm in California. Our guests are from all over the world. How is it being in a different culture where, how are people there responding to this? Are you locked down?
We're locked down. Curfew at 2 o'clock, 7 days a week. Only allowed to go out, just kind of like I think anyone in the States, same kind of lockdown as you have there. Saturday and Sundays, no private vehicles are allowed on the streets. So it's pretty serious. In Guayaquil, people have been worried about us. They estimate 8,000 deaths. That's just 3 hours over the mountain. They did not observe the quarantine rules. No one knows exactly why, but it's not a good scene over there. And we are, as I say, 4 hours away, and we've had 30 deaths in Cuenca. People here are feeling pretty upbeat, and they're observing the rules and regulations. But I'll say something about South America is that it's not like, I remember I was in California 4 years ago when there was a power outage just for a few hours, and we never thought it could happen. In Ecuador, we're kind of used to chaos. In October, the country shut down for a massive citizens revolt led by the indigenous people, and that was crazy. So people are going, this is the crisis du jour, and we'll handle it.
So when when there were civil unrest in Lebanon, Chile, you guys experienced there in Ecuador. Huge. As well,
the whole country was shut down and the roads were blocked and things were on fire. But what I loved about Cuenca, it was massive strikes. We were actually leading an expedition in northern Ecuador at that time. I think Bev is on the call. She was on that trip. We managed to make it work somehow, and we heard about Cuenca and flames, but we came back like 3 days after the flames have subsided, and it's such a wonderful populace here that they were already out, people with brooms and brushes and cleaning up the city. So we partied, we burnt, and now we're cleaning up. Oh, yeah.
I want to show a little video to give some people who haven't been had the opportunity, like me, to be with you. I've been in Cuenca, actually. I've stayed overnight in Cuenca on an all different journey there. But this is just a quick Jeff likes to say is a walk home. Let me get it to the point where I want to start this. Thank you. is that your house? I mean, I just want to get in that hammock.
it's a house that we rent on a regular basis. It's our, okay. It's our summer cottage.
The summer cottage.
Our country cottage. We go there quite often. It's just 30 minutes out of Cuenca, and it is magnificent. It's like Switzerland. Little ladies with big milk things on their back coming down the road to sell them to the big trucks that go by and farmers. It's just, it is. It's really bucolic. Wonderful.
Yeah, very nice. Hey, we're gonna come back to Ecuador, and I just love that stretch, and I love Jaffe in that video. You know, it gives me, you know, I like looking at you, but let's face it, she makes for a great plant in a video walking through those beautiful forests. Your adventure, as you mentioned just a bit ago, you came to South America for your first time in your teens, 19, let's say, and went climbing. And this was some of that adrenaline addiction that was driving the young Jeff Sauls at 20, 19 and 20. And you had quite the experience. I also wanted to mention that a lot of my people have seen the other two webcasts. We had Overland Travelers motorcyclists tune in for this webcast, but Jeff is not a motorcyclist, but if he is going to go overland, and he's done a lot of overlanding, as we'll talk a little bit about in China, but in South America, he's covered, if not 1,000, more than 1,000 miles on horseback. And if anyone who's ever been on a horseback, the only thing more uncomfortable, at least, I'm not an equestrian model, but is a camel. And horses are definitely better than a camel, but you did lots of miles. And at one point you also went over land in a very old jalopy, an old Ford truck. And then in your pursuit and this adrenaline driven rage of youth that you wanted to climb mountains, you decided to climb perhaps the toughest mountain in all of South America, not in terms of elevation, just in sheer rock. And that experience up on that rock changed your life for good. Can we get into a little bit of that? And then I want to go 30 years later.
Okay, sure. I know some folks may have to leave this because we're supposed to go for an hour, well over an hour. So,
well, I'd love you guys to stick around if you can. There will be a replay of this. Sadly, we didn't get started till 30 minutes. So I'm going to take this till 4:30 Pacific Standard Time. So we've been on about a half an hour now, 36 minutes. And some of that was still getting Jeff's stuff. So if you guys want to stick around, please do. We got a lot of great stories, and we're really getting into the meat of this right now. And this is real important stuff, I think. So stick around. And if not, I'll send you the link to the replay and you'll get it later.
Perfect. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Hey, if you just tuned in for some of you though, I should let you know this is I'm Alan Carl, host of Journeys. We're sitting down with Jeff Sauls, Dr. Jeff Sauls, anthropologist, adventure mountaineer, Hall of Fame speaker, among many other things, and he is talking to us from his home in Cuenca, Ecuador. We're talking about how to find adventure when you can't maybe leave your lockdown state, but we're also talking about journeys in the past and how they can frame our lives as we move forward and to the future. So there you are in a Ford pickup truck.
Yeah. So we, I'll tell this, it's strange when you have such a short period of time, but basically there are four of us. Two of them, Randy Udall and a guy named Bill Martin, flew back from Peru, bought a pickup truck, drove it all the way back to Urubamba, Machu Picchu, in 14 days, 1973. Then we all jumped in the truck, me and my buddy Steve McAndrews and Noel Cox, a gal from Tucson. There were like seven of us on the expedition. And we drove all the way to Buenos Aires, through Bolivia to Buenos Aires, and then across to Patagonia. And then we saw Fitzroy, which is, as you say, perhaps the most challenging, genuinely enormous mountain. There's spires and towers like Torre Eger and Cerro Torre, but Fitzroy is a mountain. It's substantial. It looks like a giant dragon's tooth rising up in the Pampa over 11,000 feet with 5,000 feet of solid rock. So it was agreed that four of us would go up, two New Zealanders and two Americans, and try and make the summit. It had been climbed twice, I think, before, second time by Yvon Chouinard. They were the Americans to climb it. We would have been the fourth.
Yvon Chouinard was the founder of Patagonia.
Patagonia, yeah. So four of us went up and only two of us came down. The other two at a moment on the mountain. We're sleeping 3 days hanging on the cliff from ropes, basically. Yeah, there's Fitzroy. So we were about two-thirds of the way up, we think, when the weather changed. So it was agreed two would go up and two would come down. And we thought the two going up were the heroes. And they would be the ones that would make the summit and be successful. And we felt sad coming down. But ultimately, we came down. We didn't see them come down the next day. And then another day later, our group found the bodies of my best friend, Steve McAndrews, this cowboy from Texas that I was just real close with. And Kevin Carroll, the New Zealand climber, the leading New Zealand climber at that time, we found their bodies at the base of the mountain. So at age 20, I had turned 20 in Patagonia. Yeah, there's me in the middle. That's me cooking on the stove. And that's McAndrews and Kevin on our first night's bivvy. There were three nights bivvy on the way up. We hoped to get up and down in 3 days. But when day three began, we were still on our way up. So we knew that a group of two would climb twice as quickly as four. So David and I, who's taking the picture, rappelled, and we rappelled for 12 hours to get back down. We obviously survived, but we lost our two mates. And it changed my life forever. It was one of those moments that you hope never happens in an adventure, but when it does, it alters who you are. It expands your vision of what's possible and what life's about. It gives you a sense of the evanescence and fleetingness of life. So I think at some level, it made me an adventure for the rest of my life, because I knew that life had a beginning and an end, and I wanted to fill up as much as I could of that middle with outrageous experiences and not waste a minute of it.
How did you drive the pickup truck back to the States?
No, the pickup truck was sold. I flew with Steve's body back to Buenos Aires and then flew back by myself because we had trouble getting the body back to the States. I don't really know. I never thought about that in all these years, but Bill and Randy also flew back. It was not something they wanted to do.
Nothing. But how do you process? You go on a mountain, you guys are looking at this big sheer wall of granite. You are thinking, yeah, we're going to get to the top. As I read in your book a little bit ago, that the peak experiences are what you make them. And to get to that peak, you never made it to the peak, and you had this this was your best friend. This was your buddy.
Yeah.
How do you fly back with his body and confront his parents?
It was a terremoto. It was an earthquake inside me. I was not at all rational. Or especially when you're only 20 years old, you don't think this is ever going to happen. You think you're invincible. And his parents, I reached out to them, of course, and explained to them what happened. And it was funny. His parents said that they knew he wasn't going to come back. There was something in his eyes, something remarkable. When these things happen, you enter these kind of very transcendental states, like his parents saying, we knew he wasn't going to return. And there was a sense of all this being right. Like McAndrews was such an amazing character. It was as if that at age 20, 21, he had lived an entire lifetime. There was even an age in his eyes. So somehow all this was what it was supposed to be. And then I was obviously supposed to, I've told the story of McAndrews and his death without exaggeration, 200-300 times for large audiences, from 10 people to thousands of people. So somehow it all, I guess when you, to make sense of something like that is you have to make sense of it. You have to say this must have happened for some reason or find a reason you can attribute to it. That's how we stay sane. And an adventure really is something from which you learn, something you invest in, and then you hopefully bring that lesson back to share with others.
Not being a mountaineer, but certainly being a hiker, and I've hiked up to Tres Lagos, which is like almost the portals of those granite spires.
Tres Hermanos.
Yeah.
Tres Amigos.
Mm-hmm. Tres Amigos. There's a photo here. I'll bring it up a bit. But if you don't make it, and in this case, that mountain, as just me internalizing it, took somebody from you. Do you look at it that way?
No, you could never attribute the mountain. It's no evil spirit. It's nothing. The mountain is the mountain. The mountain is beautiful. It's a proving ground for us and our souls and our energy. It's there for us to make of it what we will, but you never blame the mountain. You never conquer a mountain, The mountain is always your friend. The mountain is always your love.
Your love. At what point did you decide that you did want to go back to that mountain and take another stab? When did that start brewing?
I remember exactly the moment. I was walking with my friend Stephen Myers, that many people who are in this chat room or whatever, this watching this know. And I was turning 50, and Stephen Myers says, anything left in your life? We were both kind of gloating how we have no bucket list left. And I said, you know what? I never climbed Fitzroy. I still have this fear inside me. I feel like I let McAndrews down. I wasn't climbing as I should have. If anything's left, I guess the only thing would be to go back and climb Fitzroy, but that's ridiculous at age 50. And he said, let's do it. If you go, I'll go with you. And so I said, okay. You know, it was good, actually, age 50, middle age, to have something which is so enormous, it galvanizes you to getting back in shape. And so by age, I guess it was 48 when I made the decision, because I trained for 2 years intensively, took all of my life savings out of the bank so I could climb relentlessly and hire guides and teachers and climb all over the West and go up and down, go up Half Dome. You know, I got in the best shape of my life at age 50. And then I went back with Myers to try and climb Fitzroy.
I want to give some perspective here that Fitzroy, for those of you who are not mountaineers, Fitzroy is what's the elevation? It's like
11,000 something.
It's not about the height of the mountain. There are, especially at the time Jeff made his first attempt and his second attempt, there is probably, you know, fewer than you have hands and fingers and toes. And to this day, more people summit Mount Everest in the Himalayas than have ever in all of history summited this mountain. Isn't that right?
More, some people summit Everest in a day.
In a day, that's ever, yeah.
Ever summited Fitzroy.
That ever in history have summited. This is what it looks like hiking up there. Some of these pictures didn't get tilted, but that's that mountain. We saw that image before. I mean, it almost looks fake as I look at these pictures. And
I've been around the back, and it's real.
Yeah, and I will say this: I was there for a few days, and for the one day that I made this hike, there were no clouds around that, and that is so rare. That happens, they say, maybe 3 times a year. There it is. Now you could just wait up in 2 minutes, and the clouds will just come in. But it is a beautiful, majestic mountain, and you just sit there with awe looking at this beauty. I want to run a video because you did decide after 2 years of training and you went up there. Let's look at this and see how you were.
For me, what's coming up, I don't know. I want to keep the sense of mental, physical, spiritual fitness. And don't tell my family this, but Bean and I are already scheming this morning about how we might get back here and finish her up. So I don't think the ghost of Fitzroy is done with me yet. And that's actually a very exciting prospect. Because, you know, I guess that too. I mean, the value of a Fitzroy in your life is something so large and so fear-inducing that it demands from you that you be your very best. And I think if I'm mourning anything, it's the fact that kind of putting Fitzroy behind me would allow me to return to a life of inertia and sloth. Come back here in March with a small group. You know, we can do those 10 pitches. And the summit might actually be still attainable. And so just kind of keeping that grandiose objective in the back of my mind, I think, is still very useful. I mean, Fitzroy can be anything to anyone. For me, it's a stupid piece of rock, but it's a symbol. I mean, there's nothing up there. There's nothing up there at all. We know that. There's nothing up there. What's up there is only what you bring to it. And there's this great Chinese saying that you can use your finger to point to the moon, but never confuse your finger with the moon. So Fitzroy to me is just a finger pointing to how I might be in life, be better. But the truth of the matter is, where I will be better is back where I come from, back at home. And so I would say there are perhaps others more wise than I that need no intermediary destination like a Fitzroy to directly address the largest challenge in their lives, which is how can I become a better parent, a better friend, a better lover, a better husband, a better wife, whatever it might be. Because in truth, those are the real challenges. That's where the real adventure lies, is smack dab in the middle of life, nowhere else.
You got that hat.
I still got the same hat.
That's
speaking
awesome.
Speaking of hats, did you notice that on my helmet it says, I love Fitzroy?
Yes, I did know that. Absolutely. I love Fitzroy. And that's why I was asking you earlier about, you know, is a mountain ever a nemesis? And I love the way you answered that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I still love Fitzroy. I love what it provided me the chance to do. And it provided me some incredible lessons on that last climb. Andrew asked me if there are different lessons on the second climb. Well, second one, I realized I didn't want anybody to die. That was the most important thing. And I had just had this young son, Jack, I don't know if he's still on the call, who had asked me before I went on the climb, was my love for him, was he more important than dying? So I made the conscious decision with my group to turn back. And I think that's really the biggest lesson of all, is that, like I say in that little video, I had nothing to prove to McAndrews. He's gone. I had nothing to prove to myself, except to really say, I want to be alive. I want to be the best person I can be. That there's nothing up there is the key. The only where it is exactly where you are. And adventure is, like I say, it's not a thing. It's just it's a road that takes you somewhere profound and vital and meaningful. So I love Fitzroy, and I thank it for all it's done for me in my life. It took me some pretty cold, it's a snow cave that we lived in for quite a while on this last trip.
You had to, you waited and waited until you just.
Six weeks it took us to not climb the mountain.
It took you 6 weeks to decide to come home and not get to the mountain. How does that feel?
It's a great lesson. We were going to make a movie about it, but realized nobody wants to watch a movie where nothing happens. But isn't that more like life? You know, it's really much more like life that it isn't a cinematic, climatic. It is what it is. It's not really going anywhere. It's being where you are. So it was great. I thought it was really poetic to make a movie where we'd all actually make the summit, but the producers did not agree with me. So hence no movie.
So no movie.
Yeah.
As I was reading your bio and we were sorting through the technology, you know, going from the snow caves that you had to build and live in for weeks at a time in Patagonia and the sheerest, hardest, one of the hardest mountains in the world to climb to China, Western China. And you were thrown into jail in Western China. So let alone how you have to battle the winds, the mountain, the weather, and just the anxiety of waiting and wondering, to the point where you now have a whole different objective, and that is how to deal with people in a different culture and a different language. And what happened in China? How did you find yourself in a Chinese jail in Western China?
Well, I was arrested a couple of times. At least I was stopped and I was interrogated and held for a period of time and house arrest and all that. But, you know, I always want to go where people haven't been, and I always like to be in the mountains. And I'm trying to kind of like, one quest was to find the secret of Shangri-La. Was there an actual geographical location for the story of Shambhala, which is the mythic origin for the Shangri-La legend that we know because of James Hilton's book, Lost Horizon? So I'm inevitably in a place where I'm the only guy wandering around that's not from there. And I'm on mountaintops that tend to be borderlines. So I'm usually on some kind of a disputed border by myself, looking very suspicious. But really, I'm just poking around. So that's how I wound up in being arrested a couple of times by the Chinese police. But ultimately, you know, I've got to say, people are people. I was never really threatened or injured. It seemed like I was misunderstood, but ultimately, like I say, the real hero is not the Indiana Jones. That's an archetype I really don't go with. With guy with a whip stealing stuff. I go much more with the E.T., this kind of innocent stranger who's really just trying to learn something and go home. And people recognize, even if they haven't seen Spielberg's movies, I think they recognize the difference. So ultimately, all my stories have ended the same way. I wind up getting in trouble or getting lost, and people come to my aid. And maybe that's really relevant, you know, for what we're talking about, the time of coronavirus.
Yeah.
Because I think all of us right now feel really lost. and confused, kind of as you did when the whole webcast fell
Where's
apart.
Where's my guest? People are here. They're. You know, this is not the way to do it.
And everyone came to our aid. I was getting Bobo called, Dick Plush called, and my son Jack called, and you called, and everybody was making suggestions. So, you know, I think whenever we throw ourselves on the goodness of humanity and simply say, we are lost in this chaos, we don't know what to do, a positive outcome seems almost always guaranteed, or at least it's our very best bet. And that's probably the greatest lesson I've learned through my adventuring.
Yeah. And I agree. The kindness of strangers, it always comes back. You and I had an email conversation recently about some of the posts I've been putting on my blog have been a lot because I love wine. You know, it's one of my passions. And I've been traveling through Eastern Europe and the Balkans, the former Yugoslavia, Eastern Europe, and meeting so many people that are coming up out of, you know, a half a century of communism and with, you know, talk about hard times and, you know, future and possibilities and hope. And it's tough there, you know, they're still saddled with the legacy of communism, but those people that are making a way by doing something what they love, it kind of drives me. So my stories are less about the wine, although I will talk about it, have been about really the people. And it's amazing how nice you are. I crash my motorcycle in Cuenca under that bridge that I told you about as I was traveling south to Ushuaia, and I couldn't lift the bike up. And moments later, a local comes by and says, hey, can I help you pick up the bike and get it back on the road again? I just put a poll up and most people are answering it, I can see. And since we're in China, I know that you've kind of been grappling with this, you know, wondering about being an anthropologist and understanding things. You probably ate some pretty weird stuff when you were in China, as I did. And you're working on a new essay. And I've asked people if they know what a pangolin is without Googling. And we have about 55% of the people know what a pangolin is, and about 50%, it's ranging. They're still answering. Actually, now we have 54% know. We're seeing the numbers. Still quite a few people in the room. Thank you for sticking around. After we get through a little bit of pangolin talk, I want to go to Q&A. And we've got some other things that I've missed here, but we'll get to that. What is your fascination with the pangolin, and how does it relate to the coronavirus? And first, for those people that don't know, let them know. I'm talking with Jeff Sahls, adventurer, mountaineer, Hall of Fame speaker, now living in Cuenca, whose best-selling book, Way of Adventure, is the definitive source. And now we are talking about pangolins. What the hell is a pangolin, Jeff?
Well, we're this household, we're very pro-pangolin. Very pro-pangolin.
Oh, P squared.
Yeah. The pangolin may be the cause of the pandemic. No one has ultimately been able to pin the rap on any animal, but it appears that the pangolin may be the vector. If there's ever been a more innocent perpetrator, it's the pangolin. Pangolins, they're in the species, they're carnivora, they're not anteaters, they're also called scaly anteaters, but they're really more related to dogs and cats. They're solitary animals, live mostly underground. 20% of their weight is in scales. It's the only scaled mammal. Their tongues are as long as their body. They're rooted somewhere deep inside near their pelvis, and they use those tongues to go scoop out ants and termites. And they're harmless. They're not aggressive.
No teeth.
They have no teeth. They just have a tongue. They could. And so how does this wind up being the source of this disease, which has killed hundreds of thousands of people and brought suffering to millions more? Well, it turns out that these horseshoe bats, and I've been doing a lot of research, I've become kind of obsessed with this because I'm doing an article that I'll finally get out this week, and I'll if you're not on my mailing list, let me know. But it appears that bats contain all these viruses, and yet they don't affect the bats. The bats are like super virus containers. But anyway, there isn't a vector naturally from the bats. It's just who they are. And there's 20% of one fifth of all mammals are bats. I didn't know that. So bats either pooped in the termite colonies that the pangolins maybe ate the termites from, because somehow or other the viruses combined, the bats and the pangolin viruses combined and made this novel COVID-19 virus. Also, people think it may have been in the wet markets of Wuhan, where they crate these, because pangolins are sought after now because they're supposed to have this magical property in their scales that cures everything from impotence, male impotence, everything's supposed to cure that.
That's the new rhino's horn.
Exactly. Yeah. And everything, you know, depression, doesn't matter. The scales they powder and sell all over the world. And the meat is a delicacy at very high-end restaurants. So about 1 million pangolins are smuggled across international lines every year. It makes it the most, it's the most trafficked animal in the world. Million, and they're thrown alive into boiling water. They're horribly treated, mistreated, and ultimately they wind up on the same chopping block with bats. So somehow or other, the virus has recombined in the pangolins. People, they are around the pangolin. They eat the meat. Somehow they ingest some aspect that maybe even it might even be in the keratin scales. So the pangolin seems to be the vector that brought the virus to the human being. And of course, what it says to me is that the pangolins are not doing this on purpose. It's we who are diminishing the territory of the pangolin, invading their natural habitats and eating millions and killing millions of these marvelous non-aggressive creatures. It's almost like Mother Nature saying, you know, you're not just eating the pangolins out of house and home, you're eating the pangolins. So maybe this is in some way the pangolin's revenge on the species that's decimating habitats all over the world. Of course, you know, I'm sorry for the human, it's just a sorry mess that so many have to die. But I think it may be a way that Mother Nature is saying, human beings, get a hold of yourselves. Look what you're doing to the planet. And because these are called zoonotic diseases may only be increasing if we don't change our behavior. There you go.
Yeah. Wow. Hey, we've got a few questions coming through, and then we're gonna slowly start to wind this down, though I'm having so much fun. But first of all, what is your PhD in? Michael wants to know.
Pangolins.
Okay, and this was this
no,
was,
it's in folklore anthropology. So I was, although I was aware of folk medicine and Chinese folk medicine in particular, I wasn't aware of the pangolin until this. But no, it's studying the myths and stories of traditional people, because I long ago realized anthropologists are very presumptuous to go into a population and tell stories about them. Much better to meet the people personally and say, what is your story? And that's what folklore anthropology is all about.
Love it. Andrew has asked, and you may have addressed this a bit, but we'll bring it back. But in your second climb up Fitzroy, the second time, bring any special insight into yourself?
Yeah. It was that I was far too interested and needy to have specific successes, that I had attained, put importance on the highest mountain or this end goal, and realized that the life is firmly where you live it. And the goal of adventure is to focus our awareness. Like when you climb a rock, you're in that moment. So anytime you focus your awareness and are feeling fully alive, you have attained some degree of success as an adventurer. It's not geographically specific or demanding incredible adversity or living on the edge of death.
Pedro here says the virus is man-made. You know, there's one for you. I don't know, Pedro, but here's a question I want to know, since, you know, you're my neighbor here and I miss you. You know, would you ever move back to San Diego, and what would make you? If you did.
Oh, I wonder if Jack or Yeshi have kids and we have grandkids, if Jaffe and I might be persuaded. That seems to be a depth of feeling that we hear about but have not yet experienced. That seems to have tendrils that reach into your heart and pull you all the way around the world. The only reason we would ever move back is for our friends and family. But quite honestly, to be living in Ecuador at the literally where you walk out your door and you're engulfed in an adventure. Pedro's from Chile, so he knows all about living in Latin America. Pedro's been to visit us here in Cuenca. I don't think so. There's a kind of materialism, a kind of pressure and freneticism that exists in the zeitgeist of Southern California. Moments like that.
I just put up, and I didn't mean to interrupt. I was queuing up my next thing, and it's live. So finish your thought, and then I want to talk about this.
But life is all about, ultimately, it turns out to be relationship. Jackie and I love being here. We love being here together. It brings out the best in both of us. And we love the people here. We love the relationship with these wacky Latinos. There's a kind of heartfulness that is ubiquitous here. And for us, going out on the street and being able to say hi to everybody and make friends so easily, there's a beauty that exists in the nature. I don't lie in nature. I hate to say the nature in nature, but it also is exemplified by the people who live here, including my dear friend Pedro, with whom I disagree about the virus. But we'll have a conversation about that, Pedro.
Over a scotch, I think. Over a scotch.
Over a scotch.
Yeah, I agree on that. Okay, so there is a photo here that I teased a bit. So there's a story behind this photo. Now, I've known Jeff and Jaffe for, I don't know, probably it's 10 years. We're pushing 10 years now, introduced through George Walter, who is on with us, I think, still. And, you know, you lived in my backyard. I didn't know that. And we got together and I met Jaffe, and I've even got artwork by Jaffe here in my home that I'm so happy about. But, you know, for a long time, you guys were just living together. What happened?
Yeah. What happened? My story is that I knew that we were heading off to South America together, and it seemed like the kind of thing a man does not ask a woman to do without making a commitment on his part. Plus, I realized it was completely indisputable that I had met the love of my life. And so I asked Jaffe to go out to a dinner in Del Mar, Encinitas, one of those restaurants by the ocean, and never one to miss the opportunity for a good line. We ordered a seafood dish, and it came with calamari. And so you can see in this picture, I found a little calamari ring, and I put it on her finger and said, "Dear, will you calamari me?"
Nice. Come on. Is that romantic? That is.
How romantic can one get?
Come on.
How romantic could one be?
Well, you could be Indiana Jones. You know, before Indiana Jones came out, you were wearing these hats, weren't you?
I had the big fedora on Lake Titicaca. I wore it around. You know, many people say who's based. There I am. There's the fedora.
Yep.
This was many years before Indiana Jones was even born. Going around Lake Titicaca on a reed boat, I wore the fedora in all my adventures. So, yeah.
Anyway, you are ultimate romantic, and that is, I love it. I got to go back to the chat to see if we have some more. John's got some things here about we're gonna go and another thing, since a lot of adventures on there, and I'm glad that most people have stuck around. So before the last thing I want to talk about is that, you know, you've got a lot of wisdom from climbing the mountains, from being thrown in jails, from building you know, we all are some of our experiences, and we're all on a journey, and this is a crazy journey. And you and I talked the other day, and we were saying, you know what, you find adventure where you want to find it. Okay. I found it today in the technology, and when I'm done, I'm going to find it when I have to manage my edible herb garden out here. That's giving me a little bit of troubles with some critters. And that's an adventure. I've got a battle to rage, and yet I want to be able to eat these things whenever I want to. But what would your advice for adventurers of any kind, who maybe right now do feel that fear and, you know, they are unwilling maybe to risk, you know, worrying about the fatal outcomes? And I don't mean fatal in the muerte sense, but just, you know, some things might not work out. What advice do you have for people to get through these times?
Well, two things come to mind. One is my favorite bit of advice I got from a wonderful man who's no longer with us, Jeff Lowe, the remarkable ice climber, who said to me, he was already in his wheelchair. He was the leading ice climber of our time, did the north face of the Eiger in winter, but wound up getting a Lou Gehrig-like nerve disease, degenerative disease, I guess it's called, and was in a wheelchair, and he couldn't even talk when I interviewed him. And Connie Connie Self, who was his sweetheart, did the interpretation because he could only grunt, but he was in his wheelchair. And he said to me through Connie, you got to do the thing you want to do when you want to do it. Because later on, you won't want to and you wish you had. He didn't say you won't be able to, which would be kind of trite, but you won't want to. So I think in our lives, we are many people at different times. And the key to having a happy life, I'm 67 already. But I look back and I have no regrets because there's very little, there are very few times I misbehaved. A lot of my friends are on here and they know that it's true. I always misbehaved whenever I could. I always did the thing I wanted to do, which sometimes was selfish, but no longer do I want to or need to because I did that thing. And I think that's the real role of adventure in our lives is insisting that we do the thing we want to do when we want to do it. It gives us a thing to do because then we really come to know life and have no regrets at the end that we never came to know it. But the other thing is, like in this coronavirus situation, Jeffy and I, we laugh an awful lot. Some of it's hysterical laughter and probably not appropriate. But it's enjoying ourselves. You know, sadness, and there's enough pain and sadness in the world already that when we're surrounded by it, like always in the mountains, at the worst possible times, when things seem the most grim, the really wonderful adventures, those who survive, are those who now know how to find the humor. And the absurdity in that moment, people in the concentration camps that found humor, to find humor and not to need to search for it, but to see it, that delight, appreciation for any great thing. Today, we saw an interview with Sunday morning show. It was a fellow who was giving food away from his restaurant. And he was almost bankrupt himself. And he said, I'm not going to starve. I'm never going to starve. And that's it. We're never going to starve. No one here is going to starve. We have friends who will take care of us. We have sofas you can sleep on. We're not going to starve. And if we're not starving and we're alive, there's no reason not to be delighted, delighted with the moment, delighted with whatever it is, the way the shoes feel on your feet, the hand that you're holding, the sunrise in front of you. There's endless reasons to delight and to laugh with joy. Simply because we're not dead yet.
Yeah, we feel the sun on the face too. Mm. I find the joy of just when that I live alone and I've got a cat, and then when the purr of a cat that gives me so much joy that I go, I'm elated. I jump around. I'd like to turn the music up and just dance while my cat looks at me like you're out of your mind.
I said it's a great way to end this show, Alan. I think you should go for it.
Yeah, I'm going to do well, not live. We'll hold that off. We'll see. Maybe the YouTube. But, you know, I had a girlfriend who, you know, had liked to be a little bit more structured than my adventure, my curious self, and used to, you know, whenever she got angry and that things just, you know, and I would be doing something and I invite her, she couldn't do it for one hour. She used to say to me, I mean, this was a phrase constantly I heard. Is all you want to do what you want to do when you want to do it. You can't do that. And I said, oh, yes, I can. Oh, yes, I can. And that is true. It's a great wisdom. And the other is, you know, as the old adage is, you know, you never really regret what you do. It's just you regret what you didn't do. And as your ice climber said, you know, and it's not that you, how did you phrase it? It's you won't want to do it later in life. So what do you want to do now?
I want to get another glass of scotch.
Okay, good. Get a glass of scotch. Yeah. And then I phrase
it. As they say, the coaster's clear.
Hey, so I posed that question at the as we wind down Journeys episode 3 with Dr. Sauls. Jeff, is what do you want to do? And go ahead, punch into our chat room right now. What is something when you leave here, you know, ask yourself, what is it you want to do? You know, what could you do when you can do it? And we all know that's an unknown, but maybe there's something you want to do that you can do right here. What is it inside you? And if you can't answer it right now, think about it after we've wound down the webinar.
And if I could just maybe a little addendum to that. What is some adventure that you can do right now in this time of quarantine? I mean, that would be a good outcome of this event. If somehow you look now at not the confined situation you're in, but the magnitude, the wonder, the possibility that remains. There may be 1,000 things you can't do, but there's still 9,000 things you can do. What would be an adventure you could have right now, even before we're allowed to wander the streets and the mountains?
Yeah, what kind of adventure? So those two things. And Bobo just popped in and he says, look, how do you make people laugh? He wants to know.
I just say your name, Bobo.
Bobo. That is pretty good.
You know how you make people laugh? You find something that really amuses you. You give it a little dose of extreme candidness, and then you just sort of laugh. If you laugh yourself, you make people laugh. That's what it is.
This is true. Clinton wants to visit you in Cuenca. Here's some of the answers we're getting in. John wants to make a difference in making corporate cultures more life-giving.
He's a man to do it.
Beverly as gratitude and perspective. Doris says sunshine, laughter, discovering new pieces of yourself, and sea salt chocolate chip cookies. How about that? And Dick says, Dick Plush, zootic. Freneticism, zeitgeist, ubiquitous, linguistic adventure abounds. There we got a linguist in our language. All right. There's a guy who's flown around the world on an airplane many and many and many and many times. This is great. We've given our audience some things to think about. I've had an incredible time, and I really apologize again that I totally gapped on starting this. But we'll let that go. I'll fix it in the mix. And I want to thank Jeff for taking time out of his afternoon. What time is it in Cuenca?
6:37.
So about dinner time there. And you're going to open up the windows. And I heard him earlier when we were testing. We did have audio and the rush of the river I could hear out there. So it is the city of the four rivers. Enjoy that. Thanks, Jeff. Thank for all of you for your patience and tuning in with us. Tune in to us next week. I've got Ryan Pyle. He's a Canadian. He's holed up in Istanbul right now, where they are locked down. He doesn't know if he's going to get out of it. So we'll be in Turkey. He is a TV host of Extreme Treks. He's also ridden his motorcycle across the entire country of China and India. Amazing adventurer and more. Life lessons and adventures to talk about. Thank you, Jeff Sauls. Thank you. I love all of you for tuning in. This is Alan Carl with Journeys. I'll go ahead and do the old take the headphones off. I do that so I don't hear myself in the speakers. Thank you. I love all of you, especially Jeff, all of you who tuned in and had the patience and stuck around even though we've gone over. Alan Carl Journeys, we'll catch up with you on the next round. Thank you for tuning in to the Journeys webcast. I'm Alan Carl, your host. Be sure to tune us in every Monday. The time changes depending on where we are in the world. This is Alan Carl, and where will your next journey take you?